It's Sunday, May the 5th, 1996. This is an interview with a survivor, Joseph Weinreich. The interviewer is Ian Fisher. We are in Sydney, New South Wales, Australia, and this is an English language interview.
The date is May the 5th, 1996. The survivor's name is Mr. Joseph Weinreich. My name is Ian Fisher. The city is Sydney. The state is New South Wales. The country, Australia. And the language is English. The surname is spelt W-E-I-N-R-E-I-C-H. The interviewer's surname's F-I-S-C-H-L. Can you please tell us your name and also spell it for us?
My name is Joseph Weinreich. The spelling is W-E-I-N-R-E-I-C-H.
And was this your name at birth?
Yes.
Were there any other names that you were known by?
No.
What is your birth date?
24th of the 2nd, 27.
The 24th of February?
Yeah, 24th of February, 1927.
Your age?
69.
And can you tell us, and also spell it, the name of the city and country where you were born?
The name of the city is Chrzanów, C-H-R-Z-A-N-O-W, and the country is Poland.
And where is Chrzanów located?
Chrzanów is located in the south of Poland, and about an hour and a half, 2 hours from the Czech border, and the nearest city, which was about three quarters of an hour away, it's a significant city, was Kraków.
Can you tell us a little bit about your family?
Certainly. My father's name was Chaim Weinreich. He was not born in Chrzanów, he was born in Bochnia. And my mother's name was...
Can you spell Bochnia for us?
Bochnia, B-O-C-H-N-I-A. And my mother's name was Friedel, and her maiden name was Schreiber.
Can you spell it for us?
S-C-H-R-E-I-B-E-R. And I had a brother, his name was Moshe, and he was 7 years older than I. This was the nearest family.
Uncles, aunts?
Yes. Do you want the grandfathers first?
Yes.
Yeah. I had two sets of grandparents. One set of grandparents was the Weinreich, which lived in Bochnia, which I hardly knew, because they were about 120 to 130 kilometers away, and in those days 130 kilometers was a long way. And the Schreibers, which was on my mother's side, and my grandfather's name was Simche, and my grandmother's name was Malka, and we lived in the same block of flats which belonged to my grandfather, opposite each other, so I knew this family, the Schreiber family, I knew extremely well. Simche Schreiber had five sons and two daughters. Now, the eldest daughter was Friedel, that was my mother, and then you had Abish, Bernard, Yitzchik, Liza, Mendel, and my mother's name was Friedel, and my auntie's name was Mina. And they were all married, and they all had two children practically each. Every one of them had two children each.
So you had a very large family.
We had a large family, but there's two of my uncles did not live in Chrzanów. One lived in Palestine. He left Poland somewhere around 1928, 29. And my other uncle, Liza, which is named here in Australia, was Lester. He lived in Sydney, Australia. He was married and had three children.
And what did your father do?
My father was a merchant in leather. When he married my mother, it was a shidduch. In those days, there were shidduchim. You know, there was a shidduch. So when he married my mother, he came to live in Chrzanów. And from home, his parents, his father, and his family were also in leather. As a matter of fact, if I may say so, can I speak something about my family in Bochnia? Now, my grandfather Weinreich, Abraham Weinreich, started off an industry in Poland, which exists still today, and they were making what they call zakopanki. It comes from the city Zakopane, you know, in the mountains, you know, it's a holiday resort. Jackets from lamb's leather, lamb's wool, you know, lamb's skins, and embroidered for men, ladies, and also for children. And so he came from this background, and in Chrzanów he started off a business, wholesale and retail of leather.
Was it a successful business?
It was a successful business, but it was not a big business. It was you see, my father had a completely different attitude to life than say the Schreiber family. For him, business was only a means to make a living, but he was a scholar. And therefore, his business, he put effort into it, of course, otherwise he couldn't make a living. But it was not the business was not his whole life. He had different interests. And I'll tell you about those interests whenever you want.
And as far as the religious background of your family, can you describe to us?
Certainly. Shall I start with my father or grandfather?
You can start with your grandfather.
Right. Now, my grandfather was a Hungarian Jew. He was born on the border in Poland, Pilchów. We were there anyway, after the war we visited. And he came from an extremely religious family. And the name is Schreiber, right? Schreiber means writer, poet, writer. We can trace the Schreiber family right up to Chassam Sofer Schreiber, which was the foremost rabbi at that time in Middle Europe. This man had a yeshiva on Frankfurt am Main with 600 pupils, and he wrote a lot of books on Jewish law and so forth. And he's very well known in the Hasidic Jewish world as the most important man of his time. And this went through from generation to generation to generation until it came to my grandfather, which I knew so very well. My grandfather was a very religious man. He was a Jew. With a long beard, and you know, he was wearing a kittel, in the Yom Tovim. He was wearing a bekeshe with a shtraimel, and he brought up the children the same way. And he was an extremely religious man, and he was also, if I may say something, speak about him now before I speak about my father, that he was the representative of the Jewish community in his little city where we lived, On top of it, he was also a very able and a very successful businessman. He was called the king of wheat in Poland. He and his three sons and his son-in-law were in business together, buying and selling wheat to all of Europe. And also they were selling food for carbs. You know, I know in this country carbs is a terrible thing, but in Poland it was a staple. It was like a kartoffel, you know. No Jew had Shabbos without carb. So they were selling food for these lakes, you know. So he was a very successful man and a very, very religious man. And they also gave him the honor on the second day of Rosh Hashanah. He and his sons, whoever was in Poland at the time, you know, was davening the Musaf service in the synagogue. And the sons were, of course, singing with him together, you know, and it was a tremendous thing. And I'll tell you something about the Jewish life, which we let in there, that's unbelievable. Now, my father came also from a very religious family in Bochnia. They were married, was intermarriage there between rabbis, daughters and children and so forth, you know. So my father came also from the same sort of background, a very, very religious background. So they were very compatible, right? You know, my father fitted in very nicely with the whole lot, but he did not want to go in his father-in-law's business because he wanted independence. And he saw, this is what I can imagine now, he saw how intense they were working in their business, and I don't think he felt that the type of life was good for him. So he had his own parnusse, he had his own shop, he had also business in leather.
So what sort of languages would you speak at home?
Yiddish.
Were you close to your grandfather?
With my grandfather, I was extremely close. Extremely close. First of all, we lived next door to one another. And you see, I used to go to cheder, and every Shabbos in the morning, before we went to go to synagogue, it was time for fahern. What means fahern is, it comes from the word to hear, to listen. The grandfather used to ask me what actually I learned in the cheder during the week, the parish of the week. And that was every Saturday morning, and then grandmother Valka used to come in after I was a good boy, with milk and with cake, you know, like cheesecake and poppy cake. And I love it till today, of course. So, and grandfather took a tremendous interest in his grandchildren. And maybe not, but he was extremely fond of me. Extremely. And so was my grandmother Malka. Now, next question. What do you want to ask me?
What do you remember of the home? Festivals and yes. the religious life that you had?
Right. First of all, before I tell you about the festivals in my family, let me just give you a little description of the city. Right. Chernihiv was a small city. You could call it a big shtetl, you know. It was a small city. It was only 30,000 inhabitants. Out of the 30,000 inhabitants, there was about 4,000 or 5,000 Polish people, and the rest were Jewish. So they used to say in Chernihiv, you don't need a calendar, because you know when it's Friday night, when it's Shabbos, when it's Yom Tovim. And the Yom Tovim were very... First of all, every Friday night, it was a tremendous thing. The whole family used to go together to the synagogue, right? All our kibbutz, you know, beautifully dressed in the bekishes, you know, that's a satin coats, you know, with the gartels, with the streimloch, and the children were all beautifully dressed and going to the synagogue. I came back from the synagogue. I always remember my father used to walk in and with a song. I would like my children to know it, you know.
Why don't you give us some of that now?
Of that tone, you know, yes, to get a flavor of it.
Why don't you recite something for us?
Yes, he used to walk in and he says, Veshomeri benayeser well as ashabos, lios luchem as ashabos, lifnehe oilom, kisheshis yumemus vadainohoi, es ashumayim, ve es ares, uvayumashevi, shuvas, vayenufash. That's how he used to walk in. And it was festive. It was beautiful. The table was set on white cloth with the candles were already on the table before Shabbos, of course, not like here. And, you know, the food was prepared. And the aroma. And
what sort of foods did you eat?
All traditional food. You know, what's the name? Soup, fish, meats, two or three different kinds of meats, chulent, kishkis, you know, cake, whatever, you know, that was the traditional thing. It was very beautiful. Beautifully prepared, and there was such a festivity. And at the table, we were singing the Shabbat songs. It was something incredible. You know, you must understand, I've been away from home already now, 60 years? What am I saying? 60 years? Over 50 years, isn't it? Since 1939. And I still remember it till today. I still remember it. They used to sing, Oya Zoya Razoya. Oh yeah, so yeah, so yeah. Sweet, sweet. And when I sing this, I smell the soup with the bubble. You know? And what was it? Kol mekadai shevi kuru iloi kol shoimrai shabos kados mai haleloi zichrai harba meyoi al pipulo. Can you imagine how deep it is in me that I still remember that melody from home? Because so many years have passed.
You mentioned that you have a brother as well?
Yes.
He's older or younger than you?
He was 7 years older than me. His name was Moshe. Now, I had a tremendous affection for my grandfather, of course, for my father, for my mother, for God. But for him, I had a special affection. Because, first of all, he was 7 years older than me. And I remember the first time when I went to school. He said, anyone touches my brother and I'll kill him. You know? Then there was this little, deli shop around the corner where we lived. And he opened up an account there and I could take out as much as I wanted up to one grosh. You know? And he I was so proud of him because I used to go with my friends and say, look, I've got an account in here. Who had an account in Chernihiv, you know, in a deli shop? And on top of it, he was a big boy. He was a big fellow. And he was 7 years older than me. And very religious, of course, like all of us. I remember him so well because when it came to Rosh Hashanah, you see, the Chernihiv had two synagogues. There were 30,000 people there, you know, 28 with 9,000 people. So not everybody could fit into those synagogues. So therefore, they had dozens of shtibloch. A shtibl means a place, a small place, where people congregated, could be even their home where they lived, right? And they davened in there, and they prayed in there. And my brother used to go, in Rosh Hashanah, he used to go and blow the shofar at those places. And I, as the small boy, he used to take along. I used to carry his shofar and talis, because he's not allowed to. He was not allowed to carry, right? And I carried. And I always, always remember how he blew the shofar, because, you know, before you have the shofar blowing, you have got six or seven sentences which the fellow, the person which blows the shofar, has got to say. Until today, I remember, especially one sentence, because he said it so beautifully that it just stuck in my mind for all those years. He used to say, "Tif tam vudas lam deinu ki bem mitzvoy sechu emadeti." And then he used to say, it was magnificent.
Do you
have a shofar.
Do you remember his bar mitzvah?
No. I don't know about his bar mitzvah. See, because when he was bar mitzvah, he was 13, so how old was I? Six or something, you know? No.
Life in Chakshanov was like a traditional shtetl. Can you tell us a bit about how people went about their daily activities?
Yes. First of all, the whole thing revolved around religion. I made a couple of notes in here, what the city actually was looked like, right? So when they ask me this question, if I may, I'll just read you just a couple of things. So that'll give you a really good idea what Chashanov was all about, right? Chashanov, as I said before, was a small city. It had 30,000 inhabitants, so many Jews and so many Gentiles. Even the few Polish people who lived in there also spoke Yiddish. That'll give you an idea what a city that was. And we also had a few Polish people which went over to the Jewish religion. And they were all called Avrum de Ger. You know, because when they take our religion, their name is changed to Abraham. Right? So they're all called Avrum de Ger. You know, he went over to the religion. Anyway, so it was established in the beginning of the 18th century. And in the beginning of the war, 1939, it was next. It went through some very stormy times. Right? It...
But tell me, Weinreich, is there anything that really
yes, there's something
stands out in your memory?
Yes, yes. The people of Chashanov were pious, right? God-fearing, industrious, right? And very hard-working people, right? Now, okay, I don't need to read that because I can tell you all about Chashanov without reading this. It was a city which lived and was breeding religion. You know, the whole thing was religion. There were Hasidim, mostly were Hasidim, and also they had also some institutions which was a first in Poland. There was an institution which helped specifically pregnant women, ladies which could not afford food or could not afford the children because they were very religious, that every year had a child, right? And so the city was intensely religious, intensely closed. Everybody knew one another. And, even today you find people from Chashanov, they tell you who you are and who your parents were, who your grandparents are. They know you, right? And there was a tremendous bond. And there was a tremendous sweetness, right? And it went through you. You were breathing with it, right? I used to go to... So you asked me about the festivals. So first of all, I told you about Friday night. Then Saturday. Saturday morning was something incredible. The whole city was going davening. They went to prayers. The whole city. There was not a soul where they, 90% were very religious, 10% were not so religious. But everybody went to prayers. Now, then in our home, there was a tradition. In our home, there was a tradition that we all went to grandfather for kiddush, right? The whole family went to synagogue. He always brought some very poor people home for lunch, always. And there again, my mother used to tell me, when the boys were singing, right? People stood downstairs because we were living on the first floor, listening how they were singing the Shabbos prayers, because they had such beautiful voices. And they loved it, They loved the melodies. They loved the songs. It was something which not only that you sang it because you had to sing it. They sang it because they loved singing it. It was a love Till today, I've got a love for chazanut. Till today. It was intensely, intensely religious, terribly warm-hearted, very warm-hearted. They had all sorts of organizations to help. In my family, my own family, which I remember very well, which will give you some sort of an idea, my grandfather was a very tight man. He was tough and he was tight. Grandmother Malka was just the opposite. Soft, wonderful, good-hearted, you know. Not that he wasn't good-hearted, but he was good-hearted. Her life was, what did she do in Chshanov? What was her role in Chshanov? Except that she was looking after her children. She had five children, you know, grandchildren, all that sort of thing. She used to give a nadin to a girl which didn't have any parents.
What does that mean?
A nadin, she used to give him a dowry. A girl which didn't have, which was a yusim, you know, she didn't have a mother, or she didn't have a father, or she couldn't afford it. So she used to give him a nadin. She organized a flat where to live. She tried to help the young man to get a job or get into something, you know, so he could make a living. And on what I love most of all, that she made them at the wedding, the chasne. So the chasne was in the synagogue opposite, and in our place was the reception. Now, at the reception, and grandfather used to, I'll never ever forget that. The grandfather used to say, make the reception in the synagogue. Why do you have to make the reception here? You make a mess in the house with all the schnorrers coming, because they used to, all the schnorrers used to come. And she used to give them shoes, you know, give them shoes. And all the, so she used to tell them, Simcha, die versteist nicht. A Yiddish meidl misst me bescheinen. A Jewish girl, you have got to beautify, to make her beautiful. You can't send her there to have a reception. She's got to have a reception at home. Since she can't have a reception in her home, then this is her home. And I remember these cousins very well, because they were very boisterous. And when the guys, you know, especially the poor people, no relations, I mean, nobody was invited. They used just to come along from the synagogue, right? They started drinking vodka, so they got very merry. And of course, she gave them new shoes, and they couldn't wear it because they were pinching. And they would undo the shoes, you know, under the tables. And I used to go mix up the shoes under the tables. I remember this very well. So this is the type of life. Now, my uncles, I absolutely adored. They were such wonderful characters. I mean, Bernard was always my favorite. He was jolly. He was a happy soul. He used to come, when he used to go away out, you know, he used to take a bus to go out to the city, and the bus was in the marketplace. I used to carry his little satchel for him. And so he used to tell me, you carry that little satchel, I'll give you some lollies or chocolates or whatever. And when he came, he got into the bus, and he stuck his head out of the bus, next time. But when he came back, he brought me bags full of lollies. You know, he was a character. Now, Abish was very serene, very elegant, with glasses, gold glasses. He was a scholar, you know. He was not so jolly, but I still loved him. I loved his wife and loved the children. And that was Abish. Yitzchik was only newly married, you know, before the war. I liked him very much too. And of course, the other two uncles I didn't know, because one was in Israel and one was but, you see, there's a big but in here. I was telling you that on Shabbos morning, I used to have my grandfather used to have to fahern, you know, to teach, to listen what I learned in Cheda. So every Shabbos morning, you know, he used to tell me, I got a letter from Menachem from Palestine, and he's begging us all, he said, my dear father, sell everything, there's a war coming in here, big clouds are coming over Poland, over Europe, sell everything, get out, come to Palestine. And so one day I plucked up the courage and said, so why don't you do it? Your son is asking you every week that there's going to be a war, that Hitler is in Berlin, right? And there's going to be such a shocking war. So why don't you do it? So on that he answered me, I went with these letters to my Rebbe, and he was the Hasid of the Bob Veruf. His name was Halberstam. I got a photo of him.
Can you tell us his surname?
Halberstam.
How do you spell it?
H-A-L-B-R-A-R-S-T-A-M. Halberstam.
And your grandfather met with him frequently?
Oh, very. Because, you see, what happens is in Poland before the war, the rabbis used to travel. And they traveled from city to city. And the Bob, and he was the Halberstam. My grandfather was a great, he used to donate a lot of money to that movement, to the Bobova movement. The rabbi was called the Bobova Roof because he came from a city called Bobov, right? And he used to donate that money. So when he came to our city, he used actually to live in our place, in my grandfather's place. And there was such a commotion at that time that I can't even tell you. Because usually they all went to the synagogue together, so the synagogue was packed to the rafters because the Bobova Roof has arrived. He was equivalent, as you would say now, to the Lubavitcher rabbi. But of course with a smaller congregation, but this is the authority he had. And I remember very fondly that after Shabbos, after lunch, came home for lunch to my grandfather, you couldn't go in. There was food on the tables, was everything. And my grandfather was sitting next to the rabbi, and the rabbi was dispensing words of wisdom from the Torah. And I used to sit on grandfather's knees, and we each chaim from babiloch or whatever it was there with hand. I remember that as today. And all my cousins were very jealous of me because I was the only one who was sitting on grandfather's knees next to the rabbi. And the rabbi once even blessed me.
So you have very fond memories of your home life and the religious life that you had.
Very fond. I had a wonderful, youth. I mean, not youth, but childhood. Mm. Wonderful childhood, smothered in love and affection, smothered from my mother, my father, my brother, because I was the little boy chick, and my brother was the big boy, right? And my grandparents, both of them, Simcha and Malka, and my uncles and my aunties, and my cousins. I've got such wonderful memories on those times from the time I was born till the war started. And what else can I tell you about Chanuf? The holidays, the Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, Shavuos, Pesach when it came. Pesach I remember very well. Because Pesach was the beginning of spring. So everybody got dressed, everybody got new clothes from top to bottom. And of course, we went to this, and grandfather had the Seder, and the whole family. It was a huge family, and also friends. And I remember this Sederim, which I was in my grandfather's place, extremely well, extremely well. And then Rosh Hashanah was so solemn. Yom Kippur was so solemn. And it was just unbelievable. The Yom Tovim Echshanuf was something incredible. And also Shabbos afternoon, the whole city had a bit of a shluth for 1 hour, 1 hour and a half, and they all walked na Alea Henrika for a spaziergang.
What does that mean?
Is they used to go for a walk after Shabbos. It was the relaxation. Whole families together was walking, Rab Simcha, Rab Moshe, Rab this, Rab that, and they greeted each other in the streets, and that was the main thoroughfare in Chanuf, where there was the better part of Chanuf, where the nicer homes were. My grandfather had a villa in there, but it's beside the point. And all the people used to walk in there. So I remember the Shabbatons and the Yom Tovim. It was so deep in my psyche, inside me, that it's never left me.
Okay, we'll just take a break there now. Mr. Joseph Weinreich. Mr. Weinreich, you are telling us about the colourful life in Chachshanov. Can you tell us a bit, just briefly, about your schooling there?
Yeah, sure. I was going to school. The school was not very far from us. I didn't have to take a bus or anything like that. I just walked up the road. And I was going from 8 o'clock in the morning till 12:30 to Shoah Povshechna Chachshanovia. This is an ordinary school. which was run by the Catholic church. There was nuns in there and so forth. The opposite was actually a church. And we always, the Jewish boys especially, I also had the problems, a problem because I remember that as a child, that when you saw the teacher, you had to take your hat off. You know, the cap. It was a special school cap. And we couldn't take off the cap because there was the church was next door and had the Christ. And you're not allowed to do it. But anyway, I went to school in there, and I've got some very happy memories in school. And one memory, which of course I cannot forget, my first day in school, I was always fast. You know, I was always running. I was never walking. You know, I was running and creeping. You know, I wasn't a child which was standing still in one place. And I went to school, and my class was on the first floor in the school. And I went up the very first day. I think on the second lesson when there was a break, I was running in the corridor, and somebody put his foot on me. I fell over, and I broke my right leg in both places. And I was 3 months in gyps. And I'll never forget the time because, it was itchy like mad. You know, on the bottom was itchy, and I couldn't scratch it. And my mother put on the windowsill, she put some covers, you know, from the bed, so it would be soft. So I could sit on there and look downstairs and say hello to my friends when they were passing by. So the school was a happy school. I would say 90% were Jewish boys. So that was from 8 o'clock till 12:30. Then I came home, and that's where my father was beautiful. He shut the shop every day and came home for lunch when I and my brother came home from school. And we were having every day a warm lunch together with my parents, my mother, my father, every day. And this was beautiful. I loved it. The Shrivers never had the time, but my father always had the time for us. And so, and that was half past one, something like that. Then I went, and this was contrary to anything which a boy would do in a Hasidic home. Across the street, not far away, there was a polana, you know, it was a big ground, and I used to play soccer in there. It was contrary to anything, you know, and I did it quietly. My father knew about it, my mother knew about it, but they didn't talk about it, right? And I used to play soccer in there. And then I used to run home quickly and have a bit of a wash, change, or whatever, and went to the cheder. And the cheder was from 3 o'clock till 8. And again, my father was a beauty. I used to beg him, listen, father, get me out of there, you know, about half past 7, you know, 7 o'clock. I've got to do homework for the next day for school because I wasn't supposed to play soccer. I was supposed to do the homework after lunch. And he used to come to get me out. So that was schooling. I had two types of schools, Polish and Yiddish, and the cheder.
You mentioned that the majority of people in Chachshanov were Jewish. There was also an element of non-Jews there?
Yeah, there was Polish people there. And the Polish people there was mostly people which were, how should I say, laborers. And they were all employed in Jewish institutions. For instance, my grandfather, you know, he was a very big merchant in wholesale, but he also had a retail for the city of Shanov. So they had a squat, you know, which was a warehouse, and there was a train going to the warehouse where they unloaded and loaded wheat, and he employed some Polish people to unload the wheat because it was very heavy work. And every Friday lunchtime, grandmother used to make a table. On the table was vodka, shlivovitz, and ayakichloch. So the people which worked the whole week, they ate and drank. Right? So that was...
I see. And you mentioned also at school that 90% of the children were Jewish.
Jewish.
There was also non-Jewish yes. people attending the school.
Yes, very few.
How did you get on with them?
Very well. There was absolutely no problem.
In Chachshanov, there was...
The school was closed, by the way, on the Jewish holidays. A Polish school was closed on the Jewish holidays. Because nobody was attending. There was nowhere to go.
So life was very pleasant.
Very.
And tell me, as war broke out and became imminent, did you feel any change in the atmosphere in your city?
No, we didn't feel very much because there was no one. The only change which I felt was the winds which came from outside the city, right? Like my connection that anything was going to happen was through my uncle, which was in Palestine, because he was begging us to leave the city. Because when he was married, my grandfather, you know, he lived in Berlin, that's a whole story, but he lived in Berlin. And in 1933, when Hitler came to power, he went to Palestine with his wife, right? And I'm not sure whether the children were born in Palestine or were born in Berlin, I'm not sure. And when he came in there, so the grandfather was a rich man, as I told you, so he sent in, I can't remember from memory, my mother used to tell me, 10,000 American dollars, and he built a house in the Hadara Carmel in Haifa, which stands still today, six flats. So grandfather told me, you build six flats, anybody who needs to go in there can have a flat for their own, all the children, right? And this is the wind which came from Palestine, and he was begging him to leave the city. And grandfather said, first of all, I can't leave all my yontek, you know, my big properties and so on. And secondly, the Bob Varuv doesn't allow me. Not that it doesn't allow me, but he said, the Bob Varuv, he used to go to Bob Varuv, there was a Reb Simche Svetlizan Kakrik. There will not be a war. And you bleib du wie sind, you stay there where you are.
And your grandfather believed that was to
and
be the case.
And believed that, and that's what he did.
So when war did break out, do you remember that day?
Very well.
Can you tell us about your thoughts?
Yes, I was I was in Haida, right? Or whatever I was. Anyway, the war broke out. The whole city was screaming. It was a lot of commotion. Everybody was running around. The war broke out. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? What's that mean? You know, what are we going to do? And I don't want to... call myself I was smart. What would be the more appropriate English name would be, it doesn't come to me anyway, it'll come later on maybe. And I said, I always had a mind of my own. That was since childhood, I had a mind of my own. And I came to my father, I came to my mother, and I said, look, I spoke to some of my friends, and I see what's going on, and I know what's going on. Let's leave the city immediately because we are from the border 1 hour, from the German border. Once they break through, they'll come in here. My father said there won't be a war. You know, the Polish army will take care of them. It's only nothing, you know. It's a small thing. And I said, no, I want to run. I want to go. Where are you going to go? East, right? So he looked at me. And I can never forget that. He said, you really want to go? Let me find out who else in the family wants to go. And you go with them. I and my son Moshe will stay here to look after the houses, after the flats, after the business. He had a whole business full of leather, you know, and so forth. He can't leave that because people will steal it, and then you know it'll go to Levat, it'll go to nothing. He said it. So we made a survey in the family, of course, quickly, and one of my uncles, which is. His name was Avrum Harsh Blumenfrucht. He said, I'm right, and he's leaving. He and his wife and two children, two
this
my
is
cousins.
On your father's side?
Mother's side. My mother's sister, her husband, you know. He was an extremely intelligent man.
And his surname was?
Blumenfrucht.
How do you spell that?
Blumen is flowers, Frucht is fruit. And Blumenfrucht is Blumenfrucht. Blumenfrucht. And he was a very learned man, very intelligent man. So he said, okay. So he said, I'm running away together with my wife and the two children, and my two children. You can come, Friedel and Yosef, you can come with us. And we went.
How did you feel about moving away from your brother and your father?
Well, at home, you know, there was what we call a tremendous amount of derech eretz. You know, the Derech means, you know, respect. And you don't tell your father, you know, anything that he's wrong or anything like that. Of course, I felt very badly about it. But I couldn't persuade him. I couldn't speak to him. Look, you're doing wrong, the wrong thing, you know. I was only 12, right? And so I didn't feel well about it, but I accepted it, right? So we ran away. Now, shall I continue with the journey?
Tell us where you went to.
Right. So... On a horse and a cart, actually two horses, and one of those Polish carts, a long cart, we loaded up a few things. My mother took a few things, I took a few things, my uncle and auntie, and we were going towards Krakow. And Krakow was only three quarters of an hour away, 1 hour away. So we came in there, and that's when we started, that's when the bombardment started. It was horrendous. Anyway, the mother, and we were in, I knew Krakow a little bit, because my brother used to take me to Krakow to the Jewish theaters there. So I was not, so I saw the city, but I was not surprised, you know, because you saw, there's a famous Polish song, you know, which it says, I saw a cart without a horse, a tram, because people used to come from the provinces, and when they saw a tram, they couldn't understand why it was moving, right? So I was not overawed with it, you know. We were there for a day, and the bombardment was colossal. Then at night time, we moved up on the road. We were going to Lviv. My uncle said, we're going to Lviv. Now, that journey, I will never, ever forget in my life. The Luftwaffe, you know, the Stukas, were bombing us from the back and from the front. So when they're bombing in the front, you couldn't get through. And they're bombing in the back, you couldn't go back. Huh? And as a child, of course, I remember till today, the heads and the limbs and the torsos flying all over the place. And every time there was a Stuka coming, I could hear. I was very, very quick, you know. I always had my eyes open. I always was listening. I was always attentive, you know. I knew what was going on. So I said, straight into the roof, you know, from the cart into the ditch, right? But I saw, you know, I always remember always the horses when they were hit. The screams of the horses were something incredible. And the thousands of people were killed. You know, the blood was spattered all over the place. The limbs and so on. It was unbelievable.
How did your family, your mother and uncles, how were they coping with what was going on? You're only a young man at that
time.
I
was a young boy, you know, of course, you know, how they were coping with it. Well, it was tragic. It was a big tragedy, you know, coming from such an affluent society, from such wonderful conditions, right? And we're finding ourselves being bombed, and we don't know every second of the day. You didn't know whether you're going to be killed or not, that you can end up like these people which were killed, right? So you didn't know. Mm. By a miracle, none of us got hit. None of us got hit. I always remember my little cousin, he was to get under the cart, right? But I said, no, you go together with me down the way. Somehow I always took responsibility for things, right? And anyway, we survived that bombardment, and we were going onto that road, because there was only one road, one main road, which was going to Lviv. Later on, I was in Poland, and my wife and I shouted the road, you know, we were going actually on the same road, but anyway, that's a different story. So we were going on this road, and after a few short days, the war finished, in this respect, that the Russians came from the east, and they came to the river Bug, and the Germans came from the other side, of course, from Germany, you know, from this side, and Poland was divided in two zones. There was the German zone, there was the Russian zone. The Russian zone was smaller, of course, than the German zone. And we were caught in a place called Przemyśl on the side of the Germans. And there was a river going across. And we were caught in there when the war finished. And we looked around, we're alive, right? So the next thing we had to do is to find a place where to live. And I remember, I cannot remember till today, whether my uncle found it or I found it. I have got an idea that I found it. I went to a Jewish, to a home, you know, which was a wooden hut, a wooden place, and there was an old Jewish man. In my eyes, he was old. Maybe he was 50, maybe he was 60, I don't know, with his wife. And I said to him, look, we just came from Chrzanów, you know, and the war finished, and we've got to have somewhere to put our heads down, to lie down just for a few days, allow us to come to your place. And he very graciously allowed us to come to this place. And I remember this place very well. It was one room. We were all in one room. My uncle, my auntie, my two cousins, my mother and I in one room. And it was even more primitive than the Chrzanów. The woman had, the lady of the house used to have a bechka, you know, that was a casket, you know, of a wooden casket, like a 40-gallon casket, you know, like you've got wine, you know, like this sort of thing. She had water in it. From the river or somewhere, she took the water, and the carps were swimming inside. That was for Shabbos, you know, for Shabbos, to cook for Shabbos. And from that, we were eating and we were drinking that water, and it was cooking from that water, and we washed ourselves with that water, everything from that little cup, from that little thing. And we stayed, and the war, and that's where we stayed when the war finished.
And how long did you stay there, Phil?
How long we stayed there is approximately, I would say, 2 months. Approximately 2 months.
2 months. Right. And there, where did you move?
Well, now that's a big story. That's a big story. You know, the Germans were very good. Straight away, they have got Roskaze, you know, imposed was Roskaze, you know. You mustn't do this, you should do this, you can't do that. If you don't do something like this, then you'll be shot. Right. So straight away, you can't go to a shop to buy or whatever. So straight away, we're hungry. That was number one. There was no food. And then came another decree. That was the most important decree. That was after 1 week we were there. Big placards everywhere. People which do not, which were not born in Przemyśl and didn't live in the, before the war in the city, have got to go back to the cities where they actually came from. Because it was a colossal influx of people into that city, right? And so they got to come back. So of course my uncle and my auntie and my mother, we all sat down and we were contemplating to go back to Shanov. Well, there's a decree, you've got to go back. And something horrendous happened, and this turned my thinking immediately for not wanting to go back. Now I'll tell you the story of what happened. As I told you, we were hungry. Huh? And I was very quick, right? And I had a friend, you know, next door, living, you know, also the same boy, you know, 12 years old, little boy like this. And we're thinking, running to the market, running here, running there, getting something to eat. And then I saw a bakery. And there was an old boy, an old German fellow. To my eyes, he was old. Maybe he was 50, you know. And guards used to be, they used to take elderly people to guard, you know, bakeries or clothing or whatever, you know, food, guards. And he was sitting there in the sun on a box, and he was dozing. And I said to my friend, I tell her what we're going to do. I'm going to chat him up, and you run his, and you get inside behind him into the bakery and steal a couple of, you know, some bread. So we have some bread for your family, for our family. Fine, no problem. So I spoke Yiddish, and the German spoke German, but we understood each other because I understand German, right? And he understood Yiddish, right? So, because it's not such a big difference somehow in the languages. And there's a lot of Yiddish words from German, you know, origin. And I was chatting him up, and in the meantime, I saw my friend getting in and getting some bread. And he comes out with two loaves of bread, and, you know, underneath, he was weighing something underneath. And the general saw him, and he called him over. He said, you know, you're not allowed to steal bread. This bread is for the German, for the German army. And I'm here, for this reason, I'm here to actually supervise it, that you, nobody's stealing anything. But he said, I can see that you're hungry. Fine. Maybe I'll let you take it. But come, I'll show you something. And there was a box there, a wooden box. He said, you stand up on this box, he said. And he had a gun between his legs, right? And he said, you look inside, right? And you'll see a bird flying out. Magic, right? So my friend got up onto the box and looked inside the barrel. You know, he said, now what you've got to do is press this, and you'll see that immediately at once they will come out. And he pressed the trigger, and he blew his head off. Now, I ran home like crazy. That was the most vicious and the most horrendous thing that happened to me in Przemyśl. And I ran home, and I was in hysterics. And of course, I said to my uncle, I'm not going back to Germany. I'm not going back to Shanov. What we're going to do, we're going to go across the river. We're going to go to the Russians. And of course, the river was not very wide, but it was a strong river. You know, it was the stream was very, very, you know, it was strong. And none of us could swim, of course, or very little. So then we were thinking, okay, how are we going to cross the river? And as I told you, I was very quick. So I sat on a little hill, and I was watching that river. And I was watching, and there was a bridge, a wooden bridge across, which was not bombed. It was still intact. And the Russians used to come from the other side to the Germans. They were Haverim. They used to be friends, because at that time there was a pact between Stalin and Hitler, you know, and they were friends. And I saw the difference between those two people. The Germans, prim and proper, beautifully dressed, lovely helmets, beautiful guns, machine guns, and everything else. And the Russians, jolly, they, you know, dressed in scent color, horrible looking shirts with belts, you know, and with the collar, you know. And every moment they were dancing, and they were Cossack dancing, you know. And I said, that's the life for me. That's good for me, you know. They're not going to kill us, you know. And I knew already from school that they're communists, you know, and that there's equality in Russia, and that the Jews are equal with everybody else. So I said, no, we're going to cross the river, to cross on the other side. But how do we go to the other side? I was watching it day and night. I was watching. One day I saw, well, the most feasible thing is either to go by a little boat or to go on the bridge. But how do you do it? On the bridge they stand sentries that don't let you cross. And I saw one incident that the Germans, you know, some Jewish people came down to the riverbank, right? And they wanted to cross. And there was a little boat in there. So you want to cross? No problem, cross. They put them all in, much more than the boat could take. They pushed them into the middle. He put a shot into the whole thing sunk. So I said, well, this is out. The next thing what I saw was that from the German side, there was a column of Red Cross trucks. Three or four trucks with a Red Cross on it, crossing the river, crossing the bridge. And there were some people standing there in front, so the Germans started to scream, schnell, 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 across, so that the column can go through. I said, uh-huh, there's an idea. And I was watching it, and watching it, and watching it. In the meantime, there was bigger degrees, you know, you can't do that, and you can't do this. And they said, you know, if we catch you in the street that you don't belong in here, we'll forcibly, you know, and then it'll be, we'll kill you, we'll do this and that and the other one. And one day I was sitting in there and I saw a column from far away forming to cross the bridge. And I ran home as quickly as possible. I got my uncle and we had everything ready for that eventuality, you know, the little pekilof, you know, whatever we had. And everybody was at home, everybody was there. And we went in front of that column and the same story, schnell, 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 and we crossed the bridge.
And where did you end up?
We came on the other side. Yeah. Came on the other side. Where do you go? So the Russians, you know, came a Russian officer there and a Russian soldier. And he said, what are you going to do in here? Right? You can't stay in here. It's the border, right? You've got to move on to Lviv, which is the nearest city. And we went, part of the way I think we went by foot and part of the way we went by a truck. We landed in Lviv.
And you were still together with your mother, with your aunt?
My uncle, auntie, and the two boys.
And what date was this? Where?
Oh, that must have been about 2 months after the war finished.
I see. So you're speaking now about mid-1940?
39, the war started in the ninth month, in
yes.
September.
Yes.
So it could have been November.
In 1939, I'm sorry. And so you arrived in Lviv, and how long did you spend in Lviv?
In Lviv, we were there for 9 months. 9 months. And life in Lviv was not too bad. We managed to get a room, the whole family together, one room. And we were all sleeping on the floor, right? There was a shortage of food. We were hungry. But it was bearable. Nobody was killing us, and there was no degrees, nothing. You know, it was just plain, you know, sitting in there doing nothing. And I was running around the city. I knew every nook and cranny in Lviv from A to Z. I liked the place where our first president was shot, you know, and there was a corner there where he was assassinated, you know, and there was a restaurant there, you know, next door. And I had a cousin in there, which I met here in Australia later on. And so life was quite pleasant. The thing which I remember about Lviv most is I had a bar mitzvah there. And of course, I didn't have to get ready for the bar mitzvah because from Haida, you know, you open up the Bible, whatever parsha there was, I could read. It didn't make any difference. Not like you have to get ready for the bar mitzvah a year ahead. I knew it, you know, straight away. I opened up and I could read it.
Which synagogue did you have?
A little synagogue, and my uncle took me. And what I remember about my bar mitzvah, of course, was that my mother got sick. And the doctor came, and she couldn't go with me to the synagogue. And so he examined her, and he said, Frau Weinreich, there's absolutely nothing wrong with you, physically. The only thing which is wrong with you is you've got a broken heart. Because my father was there. And I went to the synagogue. I remember the little synagogue very well. I was standing up the top, and I was reciting my little piece. And I went downstairs, and everybody congratulated me. I went home, there was nothing to eat. Right? And then a cousin came to rescue. He was working in a restaurant. He brought some food. Right? And this is what I remember about Lvov, my bar mitzvah there. And when my son had the bar mitzvah here, I said, I'm having my bar mitzvah together with you.
Were you able to maintain contact with your father?
No, not at that stage. We were completely cut off.
I see. So practicing religion was still okay for you at this stage?
Yes, there was no problem. None whatsoever.
And how did you maintain finance?
My uncle took, the only thing which he took with him was a bit of money, right? So he kept us going. My mother had very little, and he kept us going. My mother had some, and he kept us going. But there was no food to buy because you couldn't buy it. You know, you couldn't buy it. But, look, it was bearable. I was hungry, but it was bearable. The only thing which I suffered from is I terribly, terribly missed my father and my brother. That was the hardest part of the lot in Lvov. And otherwise, I was running around on the trams, and I was running into the theaters and the cinemas and so forth. And the Russians were jolly, you know, and there was no problem.
Okay, we'll take a break there. You were telling us about life in Lvov, and how did you, for 9 months you were there, how did you manage to keep your grievances of being away from your father? What did you do with your time?
It was very hard. This part was very, very difficult because I missed my father and my brother something awful. I really missed them, and I missed my grandfather and my grandmother, the whole mishpucha. I missed them very much. And what we did, I think I had a little bit of education in there, but privately. You know, some friends of my uncle, and my uncle tried to teach me, because he was a very learned man. And he tried to teach me, but my heart was not in it. I preferred to go to the cinema, I preferred to go to the theater, you know, and I used, you know, to go to... just look around what's happening. And I was reading. That's one thing which my passion was, reading. I was doing a lot of reading. But otherwise, nothing special.
And so what happened after that?
Lvov. In Lvov came a new degree. The Russians had a degree again. We give you two options. And I'm talking about 300,000 people. 300,000 Jewish people were there, you know. Refugees from Poland, right? Either you take Russian citizenship, so you can remain in Lvov. Or if you don't want to take Russian citizenship, it's up to you. We're not going to kill you because of that. Then you've got to go back where you come from, to Germany. And again, we had a conference, you know, with my family, especially my uncle. And I said, look, I don't like either option. For sure we're not going back. As much as my heart was aching to see my father and my brother and all, we're not going to go back. I'm not going back, all right? and we don't going to take a Russian citizenship because you don't know what it's going to lead to. We don't want to be Russian citizens. I had a mind of my own. I really had a mind of my own.
If I may ask, how were Jews being treated during this period in the
Russians? They just left it alone. Didn't bother us. We didn't bother them. They didn't bother us. They didn't feel that they're occupying the country, you know, they're occupying the world. They felt that this is only a short-lived period because they also knew that there's going to be a war between Russia and Germany. That this was only a bandage sort of thing. So they were not very interested in what's going on in there. They didn't improve the city. They didn't want to do anything in the city. You know, everything was dilapidated, or they let it go, you know. They left us alone. We left them alone.
Right? So you were given the options?
We were given the option. So we didn't accept it. So they made a list of people, you know. They had a list, anyway. Whoever registered that he was a Russian citizenship, he got Russian citizenship. There was some people going back. The thousands went back. Right? And then one night, actually three nights, I think we were caught in the second night, they came, the Russians always do, you know, in those days when the communists were in power, you know, and then Kabarev especially, their methods was doing things, everything at night time. When it was dark, nobody saw anything. In the morning, you woke up, nothing happened. Right? Nothing happened. So in 3 nights, they were able to take 300,000 people to the railway station in Lvov, into cattle trains, and into Russia. Deep into Russia. I think we were caught in the second night. And again, they did not divide the families. Right? My uncle, my auntie, the two boys, you know, the two cousins, Moritz and Jane, and myself and my mother, and by coincidence, there was a family in there, and when we were in Krakow in the bombardment, and we were in the Kela there, so we met them there, and they were in the same working together with us, and this woman is still alive today, you know, she's in New York, and I see her.
Do you remember that night?
Yes.
What do you remember of the night?
In Krakow?
No,
in Lvov.
Yes.
Yeah, well, they took us, it was in the middle of the night. I was sleepy like hell, you know. And the Russians walked in, very, you know, with guns, with you know, with these, they had, not machine guns, they never had machine guns, but these big guns. And on top of it, that shtiki, you know, shtiki, that's bayonets. And their bayonets are not wide, but they're thin. And I always remember those bayonets, you know, they're slim. And davai, davai. And we couldn't speak Russian, of course, but we understood because it's Slav language. And we were there 9 months, you see, so already. Davai, davai, and they took us. There was trucks waiting down on the floor, down the bottom. They didn't push anybody. They didn't do anything wrong. Into the wagon, onto the station. Into the wagons, right? And then when it was full, the train left the station, and we didn't know where we were going. We asked them, where were we going? Postmortrish, you know, you'll see. And we were going. And so we were traveling 4 weeks. 4 weeks we were traveling. On the way, of course, the train stopped, and there was, you know, they gave us food and a bit of hot soup on the way, and 4 weeks. And we went as far as the Urals, deep into the Urals. And I remember the day we got out of the train, and they said, so where are we? You know, it was a small city. It was a small little city there, you know, a township. And they said, no, we're not staying in here. We're going to go. Everything is prepared for you inside, a little bit inside. The little bit inside was 100 kilometers away. And again, by trucks, on foot, you know, walking a bit on the track. There was no beatings. There was no pushing. You know, it was just disorganized, if you can call it. But we were not under any threat. And we arrived to the city called Kovestilovka.
Can you spell it for us?
It's hard because it's Russian, but in English would be something like K-O-R-E-S-T-O-W-K-A.
And when was it exactly that you arrived here? Do you know the date around?
I can't remember the date, but it was summer.
Pardon me?
It was summer.
In summer.
And it was beautiful. The trees, the air, magnificent. And we came in, and there was huts. Right, it was huts prepared, and there was a few rows of huts, 500 people, and inside the huts there was on one end there was a stove, and there was pritches, you know, wooden beds, you know, one next to the other practically, a little bit over there. So my mother and I were like, you know, one next to the other, my uncle, my auntie and the two boys next, and 50 people to a hut. And down on the bottom, it was very picturesque, very beautiful, down on the bottom was a little river, you know, a tiny little river, and it was under the auspices, there was the guards, which were there, was not the ordinary police, you know, civil police, was the NKVD. And the NKVD was Narodny Komunistaryat Nutny Dyel. That was the department which looked after spies. You know, there was the secret police. And why we were under the secret police? Because we didn't want to take Russian citizens, therefore we were spies. We were enemies of the country, enemies of Russia. The Jewish people, enemies of Russia, you know, and that's why we were under their control.
How long would you have spent in this encampment?
Till the war started between Germany and Russia. It was, I think, another year. Actually, 14 months. I can remember now, 14 months. Now, what was the job in there? The job in there was that they took the people, and we were laughing at the first day. We were laughing because, well, there was a lot of doctors and a lot of accountants and a lot of business people. They never saw an axe in their hand. They never saw a saw in their hand. It took them into brigades, six people to a brigade, into the forest, and the Russian brought their experts, you know, from wood chip, you know, to cut down the huge trees, and then to trim it, and then to cut it in 2 meters or something, and then stack it, and then when the winter is over and the water is swollen with water, the river is swollen with water, so they bring it down and they float it. I don't know how long, how far, and there's a huge factory in there which makes coke out of it. And it's like coal, you know, wooden coal. And that's used for all sorts of things, factories and all sorts of things, domestic and industrial. And that was their job. And I remember that first day very well, because everybody went to the forest laughing. You know, how are they going to cut wood? They've never seen a tree in their lives. They've never seen an axe in their life. They were sharing them. The laughter was stopped immediately because the first few trees, it fell down and it went straight onto a young girl, 18-year-old girl, and killed on the spot. So then they saw that this is serious.
Were you there?
Yes.
So you had to do this work as well?
No, I didn't do it. I was there because I was watching what the people were doing. I went with it was 2 kilometers away from the village, right? And there, it was hunger. It was hunger. We were getting a meager, you know, bread, very meager bread, you know, I don't know, 200 grams or something a day, and the bread was full of sand, you know, and there was nothing to buy. You couldn't buy anything. They didn't bring anything. You were away. Nobody was running away from there. Where are you going to run? There was no barbed wire around it. And what I remember was Xilorodovka, most of all, there was two things I remember. The commandant had across the river, he had nets to catch fish, right? So I went with a friend of mine. I always had friends. You know, my age group, I always had friends. So I went in there, and I was stealing the fish because it was across the river. He had, you know, such things, you know, to catch the fish. And I was stealing the fish. And once he caught us, and what could he do with us? He put us to jail. It was a jail in the camp, and I was there overnight. And he said, once more you do it, he said, you'll go to the big jail. Right? That's one thing I remember. The next thing what I remember is there was a man called Vulkan. That's the fellow, that's the family which I was in Krakow in the shelter when it was bombing.
How do you spell his name?
Vulkan. W-U-L-K-A-N. Vulkan. And he had a wife, and he had two daughters, and he had a son. One of the daughters was a good friend of mine. She was older than me a little bit, but she was a very good friend of mine. And I was very, very fond of that whole family. And he took it upon himself to teach the young kids in my age group Yiddishkeit. And there was no books, right? From his head. Pesach came, so he invited me to come to his place for Pesach, you know, to read the Haggadah and, you know, to participate. And I will never forget it that evening because, again, I went to the river, and this time I didn't steal, but I was catching some fish, and I brought it to Mrs. Vulkan. Mrs. Vulkan made fish something out of it. You know, she made something out of it. There was, you know, there was, they, for some reason, they had a small hut. There was only a few families in there. And there was a stove in the middle there, and she was cooking in there the fish. And we were saying the Haggadah, Manishtan Halalazay, and he was explaining to us. He was a great man, you know, he was a Chacham Gadol. And then now come time for food to eat, and she took the fish and put it on the table. On the way, she fell, and the fish fell down the floor. At that time, I made myself a mental note, and I promised myself that from now on, wherever I'll be, if I lift through this thing, that Pesach will be strict in my home, wherever I live. Till today, Pesach in our home is like in a rabbi's place. Everything is locked, and everything is shut, and everything is kosher. Everything is so kosher that you've got no idea, and I love it. It was from that moment. This is what I remember from there. And I also remember when the war finished, when the war started between Russia and Germany.
And tell me, were you able to communicate out from where you were with your family?
Now, this is a most interesting story, and I don't think that anybody has got anything like it. I don't think so. I don't know of anyone. As I told you, I was very perceptive, I was very quick, right? And I was very observant. And I saw there were Magda and Kavede fellows. There was a guy in there which was somehow a little bit more humane than the others. Not that the others one was so terrible bad, but they did their job, right? And that's it. But I saw him that he was a little bit more humane. So I said to my mother, you know what we're going to do? We're going to bribe him. I'll buy him some vodka. And I got a bottle of vodka. And I said to him, listen, I've got a request of you. There's no mail coming to Kostilovka, right? The nearest post office is 100 kilometers away. I said, where do you actually go after you finish, you know, working here? You know, when you go for 2 to 3 days, he goes as a break, you know, when he's changed, the guards are changing. He said, I live in such and such a city. I've got it written down somewhere. I've forgotten the name. 100 kilometers away from this place where I'm working. This is only a workplace. So I said, in that case, let me give you a letter to my father. That was before the start of the war between Russia and Germany. And I'll pay you whatever it costs. Send it. I said, Mama, let's see what happens. And we wrote a letter to my father. And I said, when it comes back, when we get a letter back for our name, and I wrote him down the name, Weinreich and so on, you bring it to me. And then you get another bottle of whiskey, of vodka. To our greatest shock and surprise, a letter came from my father, from Khrushchev. And that was the first contact we had from Khrushchev. And I have got those letters. And we found out through his letters that my brother was one of the first to be taken to the school where I was going to school, where he was going to school, with a lot of boys his age group, which was 19-year-old, 20-year-old, and they were taken to Germany to work. And my brother was writing to his father cards, not letters, but cards. And my father put the cards into his letters together and sent it to us to Kostilovka, and I've got them. And this is priceless to me. Absolutely priceless.
Do you remember your mother's reaction when she saw those
shock
letters?
She was an absolute shock. I was trembling, and she was shocked. And that went on for quite some time. I got those letters, and I got those cards. I translated it in English for my children so that they can understand it. And that was something so incredible, because I have got a letter from my father who farewells me, because he knew he was going to go to Auschwitz. And that I've got. And now those letters, I knew by heart, every word. And I used to keep in my pocket right through the war. Even in Australia, when I was here for the first, I think, 6 months. And I can't tell you with what holiness, you know, I look at those letters. It's just incredible. Just, you know, what he writes in there with so much wisdom and with so much understanding and with so much heart, how he foresaw what is going to happen. And he writes to me two things. To go to the rabbi and learn Torah, so there will be a continuity. If your mother hasn't got the money, So you learn with your friends. Be diligent, so you'll be a good man. And he writes to me, be in contact with your two uncles because you're going to migrate to them. Right? And on the last letter he wrote, be respectful to your mother. I've got it. I'll show it to you later on. This is really an incredible thing. And those letters actually kept me alive, you know, right through the war. Those letters kept me alive. And, you know, it's just incredible and how he writes in those letters that he feels ailend wie ein Stein. He's as lonely as a stone. And he said, with the last drop of blood, he writes with these letters, you know, and he wants to impart his love, how much he loved me when I was at home. Huh? And how my brother writes to him cards, and he says to him, send me some tobacco, send me some cakes, send me some bread, send me back the clothes which I send you for cleaning, right? And those cards and those letters are something so incredible. And we got them until, of course, the time when the war started between Russia and Germany. And I can almost pinpoint when my father went to Auschwitz. Because what they did there, it's not like in Krakow, they had a ghetto. The whole city was a ghetto. There was no ghetto in Shano, right? The whole city was a ghetto. And they took the whole lot and sent them to Auschwitz. And the young people they took first. My brother was working on the railway station in Germany. In Germany, he was working on a railway station. And he writes to his mother, I've got it so good in here. I'm so well because otherwise the censors wouldn't let it through. You know? And I'm working, helping the railway to run. You know?
And how long did you stay in this lager for?
Oh, till the war started between Russia and Germany. And then they realized, of course, that we are not spies. That was number one. And number two, they had a colossal source of manpower. If they freed us, they freed us. So they could take the men to the army. But they couldn't take them to the Russian army because they were not Russian citizens. So they made a Polish army under the Polish general, which was the biggest anti-Semite you can imagine.
So you stayed in the lager till about June of...
June 41.
41. And where did you go from
right.
there?
Right, so the war finished, the war started between Germany and Russia, and they said, you're free to go. You can't go towards the front, right? You can go inland, wherever you choose, come to us, tell us where you want to go, and we'll provide transport for you, right? So of course, my uncle, as I told you, I was a Kochleffel, you know, I was always doing something, you know? So I said to my uncle, listen, where are we going? I tell you we're going, because I knew geography very well. I like geography. We're going to go south. We're going to go, there's a place called Samarkand, and we're going, it's a big city, and it's not far from the Persian border. That time was Persia, right? And maybe we can cross the border. And from there we go to Palestine, right? Through Iran, or Persia at the time, right? We go there. My uncle was very angry. I said, look, first of all, the weather will be better, kinder. It's warmer. It's not like in the Urals. I didn't tell you, but in the Urals was bitterly cold. But nobody was sick in there because there was no germs. Right? There was no germs. It was so cold that even the germs got killed. So, warmer, and there will be food. You know, something must be growing in there. Right? I don't know what was growing in there, but it's growing. You know. So let's go south. And we got it. So we went to the authorities in there, and we said we're going to Tashkent. It's good. Yeah, przepuska tam, propuska, you know, whatever they gave us, some pieces of paper so we can go on a train for nothing. But of course, the train was very erratic. And of course, everything was geared for the army. And all the trains, all the transport was geared to go to the front line. And so we went on the train, it took us 3 weeks. And we finally came to a place, Gzilorda, which is in Kazakhstan.
Can you spell that for us?
Gzilorda, yes.
Yes.
K-Z-Y-L, cross, you know,
dash,
or, dash Orda, O-R-D-A, Gzilorda, in Kazakhstan. It's not Kazakhstan, you know, this is not the Don. This is Kazakh. It's a big republic.
Can you spell it for us?
Yeah, sure. K-A-Z-A-C-H-T-A-N. Kazakhstan. That's from the Russian, I'm spelling it. All right? So when we arrived after 3 weeks in Kislorodar, the children were exhausted. My mother was exhausted. My auntie was exhausted. So I said to my uncle, let's get off the train in here, the bus or whatever, the truck in here, because we're going by somewhere by truck, somewhere by train, you know, wherever we could. And let's stay here, say, for 3-4 weeks, catch our breath, get our strength up. And then we go down to Tashkent, which is another 600 kilometers. And we got off in Kislorodar.
Did you, is that a large city?
Quite. It's a quite large city. It is about 250,000 people, I would say. And it's populated, it is populated by Kazakhs. They are Kazakhs. They're not Kazakis, Kazakh. They have got eyes like that, yellow face, yellow skin, very aristocratic, you know, tall people. And it's, and you know, what hit me, you know, the first time when I saw them, they were wearing heavy clothes in summer, you know, with big hats, you know, and heavy clothes in summer. So why? Against the sun. So they were cooler under the warm clothes, and we were just the opposite, you know. But anyway, these people were Muslims, right? And of course, in this city was a colossal influx of people which were running from the war zone, right? Russian Jews and Polish Jews. And on top of it, there was lots of nationalities in there. Koreans, Uzbeks, Koreans, you had the Koreans, Uzbek, Chinese, you know, and from all the regions around that were, you know, congregating in Kazakh, because that was in Kislorodar, because it was a city where it was a handel city, you know, the people were doing things in there, you know, there was a market. On top of it, it had the largest, absolutely the largest rice factory in the whole of Russia. It was so large, all American machinery, which was bought before the war, and they were so large that apparently this factory was feeding 10% of the Russian army in rice. So you can imagine the scope of it.
And how long did you stay in this city for?
Oh, a long time. We stayed there. Then, of course, we did not go anymore to Tashkent because we were able somehow to establish ourselves in there, you know, put our roots in there, and we gave up the idea of going to Tashkent. And we also came reports from Tashkent that there is a huge influx of people in there, nowhere to live. Nothing, you know, you're worse off in Tashkent than you are in here. There's less people in here than there.
So you set up a life in Kislorodar?
Yes, in Kislorodar.
Where did you live?
Where did you live? Now, so the first question was, where are you going to live? Right? We didn't know anybody. I didn't know any Kazakhs. So, again, I was very quick. And my uncle was tremendous, right? He found, actually, in the city, not far, you know, when I talk about the city, I'm not talking about Sydney, you know, a lot of little huts, you know, Lepianki, you know, was made out of glina, you know, out of mud houses, you know. You know, except a few houses like the school had bricks, you know, the police station had bricks, you know, the library had bricks. But otherwise, everybody was living in, it was ingenious there, and I'll explain to you what it was. So he found two rooms in the city. And we couldn't, so at that time, I said, it's enough that we've lived together so for such a long time, right? Now let's see whether we can split, whether we can have something our own. And I thought to myself, look, I'll go the furthest place away from the city and see what I can find. So I went to the furthest place. There was a railway station, a railway line going across. And I went across the railway, and I went to the last house on the other side. And there was also Lepianka, and I go and I knock at the door. Was a huge dog, and I said, look, we just arrived, and we want, my mother and I, we want to have somewhere to live, right, to sleep. Can you give us something? We'll pay you, you know. And it was Russians, you know, a lady, 60, you know, and her husband, and she said, look, I have got no room, but if you, they all had dvoris, you know, dvor, you know, there was a house, and there was a front yard, and there was a house that way and a house that way, so it was like a little square, and with a front door, you know, you couldn't get in, right? And so on the left-hand side, he said, there's a cow in there, right? And we can divide it in half, and you can live in there with your mother. Fine, terrific. So we took over these premises, and the cow was on one side, and we were on the other side, and there was a little wall in between, and all we had in there was the man, you know, the fellow made a pritcher again, two pritches, and put a straw on it, and we had a little bit of luggage, one little window this size, looking outside onto the street, right? And one window looking into the yard, to their house. And their house was a palatial house. Beautiful curtains, white curtains. I saw the curtains, I thought I was going mad. Curtains with the chairs was you know, decked in white, in cloth and all sort of things. And the people were very nice to us. And we lived in there, together with the cow. And then a couple came, a brother and a sister, begging us, they've got nowhere to live. We got them in there too. So we live four people in a place of this size, right? And four bridges, you know. And we had a stove in the middle, and I was studying at the window, you know, at the window with a lamp from, you know, from with the wick, you know, with a bit of kerosene on the bottom, you know, and that's how we were living.
And what did you do on a day-to-day basis there?
Right, in there, so the first thing which I was looking for was education. So not very far from where we lived was a school, a polytechnica, you know, it's a, I don't know, what do you say in English? A school of, no, to learn a trade, right? So I enrolled in there. And of course I couldn't speak I couldn't speak Russian. Right? I could not speak Russian because I couldn't learn in the camp. I didn't learn Russian. I learned Yiddish. Right? And I went to school in there. But I must say I was very fast. And I learned very quickly because the language is similar, you know, because it's a Slav language, right? So from Polish to Russian was not so bad. But the writing was bad, you know, and so on. But I learned it. And I learned it very quickly. And I learned it to perfection, actually. And that's what I did in Slovakia when I was in the technical college, right? Then, after being in the technical college for some time, I don't know, in that together with the cow there, you know, for 6-7 months, or maybe more, I found a place. Actually, I didn't find it. My uncle found it. Opposite him, where he lived in the city, he found a little place, again, one room, less the cow, right? One room. And we grabbed it, and we went to the other side. So it was more civilized and so on. And there, I enrolled into a proper school.
Do you remember the name of the school?
Yes, imeni Lenina. Shkola, Mushskaya Shkola imeni Lenina. The men's school of the name of Lenin.
And what did you learn there?
There, I learned everything. Russian, history, geography, geometry, everything else. And also, they provided for us, I don't know why and I don't know how, they provided for us a teacher which was teaching us Polish. A Jewish man which was teaching us Polish, which actually was a good friend of mine.
Did you make many friends there?
Yes. There's one thing I've forgotten to tell you about the technical college, if I may go back.
Sure.
Which stuck in my mind is as the German armies were moving into Russia, the anti-Semitism became bigger and bigger. And in that school, in the technical college, I was going to school from 3 o'clock in the afternoon because I was on 3 shifts. Because there were so many kids, they couldn't accommodate, right? So it was 3 shifts, from 8 and 12, 12 to 3. I was from 3 till 8 in the evening. And it was a dark night, wintertime. And there was boys staying, 4 or 5 boys was outside the sill because I was downstairs, you know, the school. And they were sharpening a knife. And I said, we are waiting for you, you have read, you know, and we're going to finish you off. And this I remember very well, and I got out of school, and I said, no, I'm going to stay. So there was a Jewish boy together with me. There was two other Jewish boys in the class. I said, let's go to the teacher, and the headmaster, to take us home. He said, no way, I'm going out. I got out, and by chance, I grabbed a half a brick, and I threw to one, and I hit one in the head. And they ran away. And after that night, next day, I went and bought myself a flick knife. And I had that flick knife with my father's letters in here, my flick knife in here, right through the wall, even in Australia. Until my uncle found it and threw it out. Pity. My wife said that pity would have been a terrific memorabilia. But I had a knife in my pocket all through the wall. Right? Right from that point on. And they ran away, and then soon after, we found that place in the city. You know, my uncle found it, and we moved to the city.
Okay, we'll take a break there. Mr. Weinreich, can you continue and tell us a little bit some of the experiences that you had in Xylorda?
Yeah. In Xylorda, I was going to school. You know, in the technical college, I was going from 3 o'clock to late. And when I moved to the city, from 8 o'clock in the morning till 12, I was going to school. From 12, I had a bit of a break. And then there was a couple of boys in there, a couple of brothers, which came originally from Lodge. And they made what they call a stanok, you know, to make cloth. And I was the one which was sitting on the stanoki, was making the cloth.
On a loom?
On a loom. And I was very good at it. And my mother was wrapping it up around her body, and she was going to the market and sell it on the black market. So that was a few hours a day. And then at 8 o'clock in the evening, I was an apprentice in a newspaper, you know, printing newspapers. And I remember only one little accident, which I'm going to tell very quickly. I didn't like, you see, when you had the paper ready, there was only 4 pages, right? So you had to put it in a machine, you know, and screw it up. And then the machine was going with the paper, right? And you couldn't start printing until the men from the NGOs came and approved it. And one day, you know, when it was approved, you know, it was one thing written, you know, one thing printed, and you looked at it. And I didn't like the lies which was in there on that particular day. So I made it loose. And so the machine started, the whole thing flew out the window. Anyway, so I was working, it was 3 jobs, school, loom, and what's the name? And that was going in for quite a long time, on 3 jobs, 3 things. And so that's how my life was there. Now, the things which I remember very clearly in there is this. There was a few incidents which I'll tell you very quickly because we have to move on. Is number one, my mother was working in a factory to make clothing for the army. And later on, my uncle became one of the chief accountants in the rice factory. He was a brilliant man. The man was brilliant. And so he fixed up a job for my mother in the rice factory. So first of all, it was not so hard. The job was not so hard. And second, she could steal a bit of rice. Huh? So she was working there too. So what I remember about the rice factory was this. It was about, I would say, 400 Jewish people was working in there. Well, she showed me Yom Kippur comes. Nobody wants to go to work. But how can you get out of it? You've got to have a spravachka from a doctor that you are dying. You're sick, so sick that you can't that you can't go to work. And it was a Russian Jewish doctor, and he gave everybody a spravachka that they're sick. Right? He, of course, his job was online, and nobody would have believed him, but they shut their eyes. Next to us where we lived was a little rabbi, you know? And you know, in those in Kazakhstan, there was, as I told you, squares. You know, you walked and there's a door, and there's a house this way, a house this way, and a house this way, you know, and you close the door, you don't know what's going on inside, right? So everybody ran in there to the rabbi for prayers. And we were there for prayers. All of a sudden in the afternoon, it was Yom Kippur afternoon, 2 truckloads of the secret police arrives, they seal it off, and they run inside, they break the door and run inside. And at that time, there was a decree, only 3 people could meet. If more than 3 people meet, you've got to have they were worried about some sort of a conspiracy. So what are you doing in here? So many people, it was about 100 people in there, you know, all praying. Try to explain to them that this is a holiday. What holiday? It was an atheistic, you know, society that didn't know about all this. It took us all, including me, into the station. We come to the station. The chief of the police in Kazakhstan, in the NKVD, was a Jewish man called Miller. I'll never forget it.
What was his name?
Miller. And he was small, and his bodyguard was twice his size. Right? He was always running around with his bodyguard. And he started to scream. Every minute of the day, our brothers and sisters are being killed on the front. And you are going to, and you're going to pray? He said, there's no God, there's nobody like that. Now get the hell out of here, I don't want to see you anymore, and go back to work or go back to your home or whatever. We all went back to the rabbi, for needle service. Miller arrived out of his uniform, in civil clothes instead of Kaddish. I could never in my life believe it. It was a very tragic story with Miller, he had a son, a young son, and he was a lieutenant in the army. And he was his group was one of the first to break through in Berlin. And actually, he was killed in the Reichstag. And the whole city was weeping. This is what I remember about Zlodar, that's one thing. Next thing what I remember about Zlodar is this. I was waiting on the stanok, you know, in the room. And my mother was going to the market, and she was also buying a bit of rice and selling a bit of rice to make a bit of money, you know, when the war's finished, or when we go home, we have something to start with, right? And one day she comes home, and she said to me, there's a man I met on the market, a Jewish man I met on the market, and he's giving me a tremendous good rate to buy Shvinki. Shvinki was American gold dollars. And so she got all together, all the money which she had at home, and she went to a couple of the neighbors to borrow some more money, and she went to the market. And she came to the market, and she came home. She was very happy that she's such a good deal. And the money was in a tube. And I'll never forget it. She pulls out a tube on a table there, you know, a little table. So the first three was gold coins, and the rest was kopeikis. And I knew that there's a train going to Tashkent, and I'll catch that fellow. I said, how does he look? So she said, I ran to the train, and I felt it, that this is the fellow. And I said to him in Hebrew, I said, Tumas nafshim pelishtim. I said, you'll die together with me. I said, you don't give back my mother the money. I said, you'll finish up in jail, we'll finish up in jail. You're not allowed to sell, I'm not allowed to buy. Right? So he said, okay, let's go outside. And he ran between the trains, and I couldn't catch him. That was and then, when I came home, I'll never forget it, my mother was in utter despair. Not because that she lost her money, but because she borrowed the money from her neighbors. 3 days later, I'm going to the post office. We were going to the post office, you know, to see whether any letters arrived, whatever. Two parcels arrived from Warsaw. I had a cousin which was an army officer, and he was stealing some stuff there in Warsaw from, I don't know who from, and he sent us, it was clothes, suits, shoes, socks, shirts, two parcels. I went to the market to get it with my mother, we sold it, and we repaid everybody. And I've got a photo of this fellow, you know, I've got it here because he lived in Australia. That's the second thing. The third thing which I remember, which was very interesting, was in school, when I was going to school, that year nine had three classes because there was such an overflow of kids, you know, three classes nine. And I was in the highest of the three classes, you know. The brightest kids were in that class, and not so bright in this, and the dumb ones in there. So I was in the highest class. Next to me was sitting a Kazakh. And very fine fellow, tall, fine fellow. And he used to take me to his home. And, you know, I just wanted to give you a quick description of the home. You know, they had a mud home, and very ingenious, you know, it was a hole in the floor, a hole, and they used a little bit of wood, but it was going right around the floor into the walls and out in the ceiling. So with a little bit of wood, they had a warm house, because in wintertime it was bitterly cold in there. There was no snow, but it was bitterly cold, you know, windy. And one day, the director of the school comes into the class with one man from the NKVD, and he said, listen, boys, we know that this is the highest, the more intellectual class of the three, and we give you a wonderful opportunity. They put on three sentences on the blackboard. You answer it, you've got 2 hours to answer it, either one of those, political things. And then we give an opportunity to three boys to go to Moscow to go into the diplomatic corps, right? And I was very interested in politics, always was very interested in politics. Not only that, but I used to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning, and there was a huge map in the corridor, and I was the one who was telling anybody what's happening in the world. You know, and I always remember the fellow which was on the radio was saying, "Naši vojska zaňali Kharkov," you know, "our troops have today, you know, occupied such and such a city." And I used to, with flags, I used to shout them the troop movements of the Russians and Germans and so on. Very interested in that. I was very interested in it. And anyway, after two days later, the director calls in my friend, which was sitting next to me and another fellow. And he said, "You three were privileged, you know, and you are going to go to Moscow to a diplomatic corps school." I said, "I would like to go very much, but I'm not a Russian citizen, right? I'm a Polish citizen." "Oh, we can't have you, right? We don't, no, only Russians, you know." No. Right. So they left me behind. A year later, I walked down the street and I see this fellow beautifully dressed in a beautiful uniform with gold epaulettes. "Yosif, at the tea?" You know, I said, "Yes." "Well, my friend the Kazakh." I said, "Let's go to the China, you know, the tea, let's have a cup of tea." And his first words to me were like this: "Atamada berbe ivrit? Do you speak Hebrew?" In Hebrew. And I said, "What the hell happened to you?" So he told me they took him to Moscow, into diplomatic corps, into the school, and they had a professor of some kind of Hebrew, and they were teaching them. I said, "What do you need Hebrew for?" So he said, "Look, the war is going to finish very shortly, right? And the Jews are communists, as you know, because we've got all the commissars here, Russian Jews are, you know, are the very good communists. We are going to establish, we're going to help you to establish a Jewish state in Palestine, and it will be the same as in Poland. We're going to set up a communist state in there, and this will be the springboard for Africa and India." And all our diplomats, wherever they go, they know the language of the country, and they know the history of the country better than the natives. And because I have got this, because the Kazakh had a guttural voice, they spoke from, you know, not from inside. So they put me into the Hebrew section, Drevnye Evreisky, and he was speaking Hebrew. It was just an amazing story, you know. I could not believe it. I'm positive that when the Russian embassy was consulate was in Tel Aviv, he must have been one of them. That's fascinating.
Quite remarkable.
Yeah.
Very remarkable.
It's a remarkable story. So that's the second story which I remember from Brazil. These are the stories which come through my mind.
So for you living there, you were able to earn a living with your mother?
Yes, but we lost everything.
Right. Were you able to then put together more money again? And
A little bit of my money by selling the clothes which my cousin sent.
Yeah.
A little bit, not much.
You seem to have managed to keep in touch with what was going on in the war.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. You know, I was always, I love politics. And Mr. Vulkan, you know, because he taught me Hebrew, he taught me Yiddish and so on, I had to read the Russian newspaper, what Churchill said and what Roosevelt said, and translate to him in Yiddish.
Did your family stay healthy during this point in time?
My family stayed, no. You see, now we're coming to an age, to a stage where it was the most bitter time for my life. First of all, we were very hungry, that was for sure. You know, we were hungry, but it was bearable. We were not more hungry than the Russians, because everything was going to the army, right? So you could excuse them. Now, the only thing which happened was that in Kazakhstan, unfortunately, you know, because of the climate, it was warm and so on, typhus was raging. It was an epidemic. And I was one of the first to get typhus. There was two types of typhuses. Came from the stomach and from lice. And I got sick. I can't remember which one was first, but I got sick. And I was taken to the hospital, and there was absolutely no medication. And the doctor said, I'm not going to live. I'm not going to survive. So I did survive without any medication, without anything, you know, a bit of aspirin or something, whatever they gave me there. And as soon as I got out of that, first, typhus, imagine I got the next one. So in 1944, I had two typhuses. I was sick twice on typhus, and on both occasions, I was not supposed to be alive. And I went through, and that was the most bitterest time of my life, was 44. And therefore, I want to tell my children, and they know it very well, that my philosophy in life has always been, since then, 1944, it's not. No matter what happens in life, so I always say to myself, 1944, it's not. If I overcome that, I can overcome this. This is peanuts against what happened there, right? And then, unfortunately, my beloved uncle, Avrum Hirschblumenfeld, got sick on typhus. And because I had typhus twice, so I was regarded as I'm immune. And we bribed the staff in the hospital, if you could call it a hospital, because there was bed one next to the other. There was no room to go in between. Huh? And the professor was a Jewish man, and he was so poor that he was wearing a woman's coat. And I was lying next to my uncle for 10 days, and he died on my hands. A young man, brilliant young man, with a brilliant mind. And he was to me like not like an uncle, like a father. Because I didn't have my father. My father was, you know. So that was very bitter. That was the worst time in my life. After two typhuses, which I went through, Mr. Vulcan's son died on typhus and was such a tragedy in there, I can't even tell you. He had three daughters and a son. And the youngest was the boy. A brilliant young man also died. Thousands upon thousands of our people died. It caught you, 10 days, finished.
You were very lucky to survive.
Very lucky to survive. And that's how I survived in Zilorda.
So you stayed in Zilorda until when?
The war finished. As a matter of fact, we're doing this interview on the 5th of May. That's when the war finished, on the 5th of May. How many years ago? That's the war 51 years ago. 51 years ago to the day. Today we're making this interview.
Do you remember the end of the war?
Very well. I remember, the radios were full blast. Everybody had their radio, it was full blast. Mir, peace, right? Vaina akonchilas. And, the war is finished. And, and they were screaming from everywhere. Naše djelo pravoje, our cause is right. Right? We were victorious. We're victorious. And Stalin at that time did not say za Stalina, to go to fight for Stalin, za Rodino, for your country. Right? And, the atmosphere was electric. 24 hours, the people were dancing in the streets. There was non-stop. There was music going from everywhere and anywhere. And there was the Cossacks and this and that. And all the dances, the Russian folk dances. And it was drunkenness. But it was in a jovial mood. It was colossal. It was colossal. But soon after the war was finished and so forth, there was a fear in Russia, a colossal fear. I don't know. The world doesn't realize it, what a fear it was. The Americans dropped the bombs in Nagasaki and Hiroshima, and they were frightened that the next lot would be on Moscow and Leningrad because they knew that they hated the communists. So there was straight away, after that mood of happiness and joy, there was a mood of fear. Because at that time, Russia didn't have the atom bomb yet.
And what did you decide to do with your mother at that stage?
At that stage, we couldn't do anything. We just stayed where we are. And then they came to us. They announced who. And that is where our thoughts in Lvov was right. Whoever is not a Russian citizen cannot stay in Russia and cannot stay in Zlorda, but you have to go and register and go back to where you come from. And that's why we're justified not to take the Russian citizenship. So it took a while before the war finished in 45, and we were given permission to go back to Poland. Not permission, but we were allocated room. It was cattle trains again. And in 46.
Did you know the fate of the rest of your family?
No.
At that stage?
No. We had no idea.
So you went in 46 back to
Poland.
Yes.
And the journey took us 4 weeks. Again, I was a Koch level. You see, there was a commandant there which was organizing food and so on. I was his helper. And I was weaving a pyjama, which my mother made, I was weaving it, my mother was sewing it. And after I got married, I took it home. And the second or third day after my marriage, my wife thought it was a piece of schmata, so she threw it out. Anyway, so we went back to Poland. From Gzelorda, we went back to Poland. There's one thing I want to tell you what happened on the way, you know, one little thing, two things actually, to give you some idea what was going on. First of all, there was a train load of 500 people. Again, somehow always they had train loads of 500 people. So many wagons and so many people in one wagon. So again, everybody was lying on the floor, on a bit of straw. And I was always thinking, and they said in Poland there's a lack of salt. That for salt you can, it's like gold, and also rice. So we were in Zloda, was plenty of rice. You know, we bought some rice, and on the Caspian Sea, when we passed the Caspian Sea, we bought salt because that's where the salt. And so I had two big bags, one rice and one salt, and a few schmattes, really a few schmattes. And on the way we were going towards Poland. And of course the trains with troops were coming back. One more thing I forgot to tell you, in Zlorda, I met, when I was on the railway station, there was a passenger train, and out came German officers, and von Paulus was there, and I saw von Paulus. You know, that was the defender, the marshal, which was fighting for Stalingrad, right? Anyway, so, and trainloads of German troops which were coming back, you know, and they were chucking out the dead on the Rhine, you know. And so going back to Poland, on the way there was such misery that you have never seen in your life. Because a lot of people came out from concentration camps, Russian concentration camps, spies. They were supposed to be spies, you know, and all sort of things, you know. And they were sitting there on the lines when the train stopped and begging for food. And about a day before we arrived in Poland, we went again to Przemyśl, same city where, you know, when they caught us here, just a day or 2 days before we. I saw these people sitting in there, in terrible conditions, you know, full of lice, you know, and on their shoes instead of shoes they had pieces of you know rubber, you know, from the cars, you know, and so forth. And one fellow was looking up at me, with such sorrowful eyes. And he said to me in Polish, "You're going back to Poland?" Czy pan jedzie do Polski? No tak. Czy może mnie pan zabrać ze sobą? Can you take me with you? I said, "How can I take you with you? You got documents to go back to Poland?" He said, "No." So how can I take you? My mother said, "Take him." I gave him my hand and I grabbed him and I took him up, and the train started to move. My mother undressed him from top to bottom, threw out all his clothes, and everybody gave him something to, you know, I gave him a pair of trousers. I don't know what I had, trousers, extra trousers, gave him a trousers. My friend, without legs, gave him a shirt, you know, like from a marina, you know, from a sailor. And anyway, he's coming with us. Okay, we come in the morning, early in the morning, we're coming to the border, until we saw the border. You know, coming to the border. So, door opens up, an officer with two soldiers, again with these guns, you know. Who speaks Polish and Russian? I do. Okay, we will call out the names of the people, you, and every name which we call out, you take the document and give it to me, and the person goes down. I said, fine. So I call out the names, it was about 30 people, 40 people in the inside. Now I knew that I've got this fellow, he's got no documents, what am I going to do with him? Anyways, I pushed him towards the front. I said, "I already said your name and your document, get down." So he jumped down and he disappeared somewhere. He was there. A sigh of relief. After everybody was down, he said, "Now we're going to do the reverse. The documents, and everybody goes out." And so everybody went out and he stays there. He said, "And who is this fellow?" I said, "Oh, look, he's a Polak. He wanted to go to Poland. He's from the concentration camp. You know, he did nothing wrong. You know, he was a thief or something." He went up to him. I'll never forget that. He gave him one, two. And he said, "Ty po moriam plawać bolsze nie budzisz. You will never sail any more the seas." a shirt of a sailor. And he took him. And he said, "You are lucky that we're not undoing your part of the train, because you're in the middle, you know, and it was hard for them to shout it out. Otherwise, the whole train would have stopped in here. You wouldn't cross the border." We crossed the border. Crossed the border. Why I'm telling you that story about this Polak, because there is a sequel to it. Across the border, and they said, "You cannot stop anywhere. Nobody can get out of the train. The whole train goes to Silesia, to the part of Poland where Poland passed Kraków, passed Katowice, into the German part where the Poles, you see, the Russians took a part of Poland from one side, and the Poles took a part of Germany from the other side. So that's where you're going to go, because that's where you need the people. We don't need you in any other city. Again, I was very clever, right? And we arrive in Płaszów, in Kraków. You know, that's a suburb from Kraków. And I said, you know, my uncle died, right? So I was the man of the family. I was the one who made all the decisions. I was 19, huh? Made all the decisions. I said, we're going to try to get out here. Because what are we going to do in Silesia there? There's nobody there. In here, there could be some Jews in here. It's a big city. You know what I mean? We want to go from here. We want to go to Palestine. We want to go to Israel. We want to Australia. You know, what are we doing here? Anyway, the train stopped. And I jumped down from the train down, and there was sort of a bridge, and under the bridge, a Polish fellow was with a horse and a cart. And I said to him, I've got two women and two children and a little bit of luggage, and I'll pay anything you want to take us to Kraków. Well, the fellow had his money, you know. So yes, I went up to the train, and can you imagine with what hardship I had to get the two women down and the two boys? Two boys was no problem, and that bit of luggage. I had a bag of rice and a bag of salt, heavy like hell. Anyway, we got it down, and we got it all down quietly, and we started to move to the city. He said, "No kompaczeja, where do you want to go? Give me the address." I said, "Let's go and I'll tell you." I said, "To tell you the truth, I don't know where to go. I've got no place where to go." So he said, "It's quite obvious to me." He said, "You're Jewish." I said, "Yes." I said, "There is a house in Kraków which looks after the refugees for a few days until it gets itself sorted out." I said, "That's where I want to go." And as we are going like this, and it was starting to drizzle, it was raining, and I said, like this. And a woman was sliding up to me. She said, "Are you going to Kraków?" I said, "Yes." "Can I come with you? Because it's too dangerous for a woman on her own to go to walk to Kraków." I said, "Of course." I look at her, and she looks at me, and she said to me, and I look at her, and I said, "I'm who? You Jewish? I'm who means my folk, my people?" She said, "Yes." "Huh, so we're home." I said, "I'm going to ask you a very stupid question." I said, "I've got a cousin, which I believe has lived through the war. He was in the partisans. His name is Joseph Goldberger, and he's a dentist." I said, "I know him, and I know where he lives." And she took us to my cousin's place in the middle of the city, you know. I knock on the door, and he looks at me, and he comes out. He looks at me, and, "Who are you?" I said, "My name is Josef Weinreich." "My God, Father. Who are you with? Where are you from? You know, where you come from?" I said, "Okay, this very minute we came from Russia. My mother and my auntie, Mina, and the two boys there." He ran down like crazy. He took the luggage, put it in his keila, you know, down the bottom, and he took us upstairs. First we had a shower. Then he gave us something to eat. Then we all lie down on the floor. Next day I went with him, and we found one room in Podgórze somewhere there. You know, we all lived together. I found that place on my trip to Poland. I found it. And we all lived in there.
And how long did you stay in Krakow for?
In Krakow we stayed for 9 months. The reason why we stayed in Krakow for 9 months, because we were going to go to Israel, to Palestine. But there was no possibility of going to Palestine because you couldn't get any documents. The English didn't allow you to get in. And we were not going to go on a ship and jump 3 miles from the shore and swim to Palestine. There was no question about it. With two women, with three children, you know. So we were going to fix up documents to go to Australia. And we immediately wrote to my uncle here, Lester, which his first name, which was Liza actually, in Poland. And then he guaranteed that he's going to give us work and he's going to look after us when we are in Australia until we, you know, work and whatever. And it took me 9 months to get the documentation to go to Australia. And there was one. 9 months, because we had to have like this: exit visa from Poland, go through three zones in Germany. That was the British, American, and French. That was not so bad, but we had to get the entrance visa to go to France, which was a hell of a job, because they wouldn't give you a visa to go to Paris unless you had booked something to leave the country within 3 months. Right? Either a ship or you had to have documents and you had to have tickets to go further because they didn't want you there. Right? So that took 9 months. And one of those trips I remember very clearly, which was also very tragic. Now, have I got time to tell you that story now or not yet?
No, we'll save it, I think, till the end.
Right.
What date was it when finally you got your visas?
We got the visas. It was somewhere in, I think it was in April, because in June we left Paris.
I see. So in June of 1946?
In June 47.
June 47, pardon me. You left from
Marseille.
From Marseille to Australia.
To Australia, on a ship.
Okay.
But I would like to tell you one little story about...
We'll just hold it for one moment, take a break for 1 second. You wish to tell us a story in Krakow that happened before you left for Australia?
Yes. First of all, when a Jew comes to a strange city which he doesn't know anybody, he goes to the synagogue. And I went to the synagogue, which I remember very clearly was on the first floor in Podgórze somewhere. Well, when I say synagogue, it was a shtibl, right? And they told me that the week before, at that time there was still lawlessness in Poland, you know, the people were getting killed and for no reason and so on. And they took out 27 people out of the synagogue the week before and they shot them. The Polaks. Right. That's not one story. The next story is my travels to Warsaw went as follows. I couldn't go from Krakow directly to Warsaw. I had to go to Katowice to catch the train to go to Warsaw, right? Because that line was not open yet from Krakow to Warsaw. And the trains had no windows, right? They had no windows. It was bitterly cold. And my mother was very clever because anti-Semitism was raging in there. When they saw a Jew still alive, they couldn't believe it. They just could not believe it. A Jew was still alive. We don't want you here. Hitler didn't kill you yet. Where did you escape? Right? So she bought me a Polish coat from the army, an army coat, and she said, always have your collar up. And she bought me such a cap, you know, a Polish military cap, and that's how I was traveling. And by the way, I was also inducted into the army. I didn't realize it, you know, only now when I looked through the phone. But I didn't go, of course. Anyway, what I remember about one trip was I was sitting in a train, it was dark, nighttime, and there was a young couple sitting opposite me, and somehow Jews, they smell one another straight away, and straight away I saw them, they're Jewish. They didn't know I was Jewish, but I saw them that I was Jewish, and I look at them, I said, I'm who, yes. I said, where are you going? He said, we're going to Warsaw to fix up a few documents because we've got to go to Melbourne. We're going to Melbourne. They're newly married and they're going to Melbourne. So I said, we're going to exchange, you know, telephone, you know, addresses when I'm in Sydney. We'll see each other. And the train used to stop very often on the way, you know. The trip now, by plane, takes 50 minutes. By train, I think it takes 4 hours, you know, whole night. You know, 12 hours, whatever, you know. It's impossible. Anyway, the train stopped. It was pitch dark. And some hooligans came into the train, and they looked with torches, and they looked at these people. These are Jews. They took him out right in front of me on the embankment, and they shot him dead. This I'll never forget. Young couple survived the war. We're going to Melbourne, and they got shot, in Poland, you know, after the war. And I'm talking about 47. That's incredible. And it was a colossal antisemitism, colossal. You know, now I'm coming back to that Polak, right? And one of those trips in Warsaw, you know, so I came in the morning. Right? Used to, the train used to go at night time, I came in the morning to Warsaw. Straight away, I went to the various embassies. We had to go to get the papers, because I was fixing up for my auntie and for my two cousins and my mother and I. And I went straight there, and queues and waiting and money and this and the other one. And my mother used to give me a sandwich, you know, to eat on the way, you know, because there was no restaurants, there was nothing. And I finished the work once at 5-6 o'clock in the evening. Everything was shut, and I had nothing else to do. And also, you know, I finished what I wanted to finish on that particular trip, and I go to the train to get the train back to Katowice and back to Krakow. And I was sitting in there having a cup of tea, and comes a young man, beautifully dressed, beautifully dressed. And he looks at me, "You said?" I said, "Yes." "Ten Żyd uratował mi życie. This Jew saved my life." I said, "That's you?" He said, "That's me." He said, "What are you doing in here?" I said, "I'm just taking the next train. I'm going to Krakow." "Where's your mother?" "He loved my mother. My mother's in Krakow." He went and got himself a ticket, and we went back to Krakow together, as he stood. I said, "What happened to you?" They took you off from that, you know, near Przemyśl, you know. They took him to Moscow. They put him in jail in Moscow. And they checked out all the things which he told him, which concentration camp you go, why he got out, why he got in, and so on. And finally, they gave him a ticket to go back to Poland, right? Came back to Poland, and no one. He found out his father was in the Polish army in London, and every ship which came with people repatriated, the father sent him money, and he sent him, you know, goods. He sent everything. He was a rich man. And he came, when I never forget it, I opened up the door, and my mother was there, you know, and I came in. And I said, "Who's this?" You know? And in disbelief, he lay down on the floor crying that we saved his life. Right? And so that's what I wanted to tell you about the Polish trip.
So you eventually made the decision to come to Australia. You bought
There was no decision. I mean, we couldn't make any decision because we couldn't go to Palestine. We wanted to go to Palestine because Mendel, my mother's brother, you know, my uncle was writing, "You come to Haifa, there's a flat waiting for you. It's not mine, it's yours. And also Mina with the children, there's a flat waiting for you," but we couldn't get in. So we went to Australia, we came to Australia.
And how did you find the culture here in Australia when you arrived in comparison to what you experienced in Europe?
Completely strange. I could not reconcile myself. Because when we went through the Panama Canal, right? So the Jewish people, they were waiting for us. They gave us a big banquet, and they were crying that we are alive and so on, you know. And we would say, "Well, you're crying. We should be laughing, you know. You know, we were alive." And with such a warm atmosphere. We came in here. It was just the opposite. I mean, it's hard to speak about it. But you know, the Australian population, to the Australian population, we were wogs, right? They hated anybody who didn't speak English, or who looked a little bit different than they, or did think or eat something different than they did, and they hated us. They hated us. But this was bearable. This you could understand. They used to tell us, "You're going to take our jobs away. What are we going to do? We don't need you. This country is a happy country. We don't want you. Go back where you come from." That's all. And we used to tell them, "Look, when we start working, they will work for us, they will work for you, they will work for everybody." This was bearable. But the biggest anti-Semitism came from our Jewish people. There was the Anglo-Saxons. You know, the great synagogue had Anglo-Saxon people. And it's a very well documented fact. And one perhaps shouldn't speak about it, but if you ask me, I'm telling you that there was a president called Saul Simons. And he actually wrote a letter to the government asking them not to allow the Jewish people in. Only 25%, say if a boat comes with 500 people, only 25% should be Jewish. It's documented, right? And only the next to the family, you know, like father, mother, brother, and so on. There's a fellow called Fink was in Melbourne, and he rang up Arthur Colville asking him and begging him and crying that there's a ship come with 500 people, John DeWitt, and they were going to send it back to Poland, to Marseille, to allow these people to come into the country. So he allowed them. And there is a letter from Simons telling off Mr. Colwell why he allowed it, without consulting him, right? So I could not understand these people here at all. I didn't get on with them very well at all. I just could not. And on top of it, you see, my uncle and his family had a seat in the Great Synagogue. And I didn't want to go to synagogue, right? Because why I didn't want to go to the synagogue is because all through the war and after the war, I was blaming the Bobova Ruth, which his name was Halberstam, that he told my grandfather not to leave Poland. And this was killing me, right? And I, from being very Orthodox, I became the other way, right? And you know, then I started to question God and the whole thing, right? And on top of it, if there was a God in heaven, and my father was so pious, and he was so religious, and he observed all the 365 commandments, which was, and my grandfather, why did he get killed? Where was God? And then, you know, a Jewish person, you know, the first thing a Hasid says is, Ani ma'amin beviat ha-Mashiach. You know, I believe in coming of the Mashiach, and I couldn't believe that Mashiach is going to come. I just could not believe that. Now, the young people, again, my age group, right, I had a very good experience. I lived in Kuji, and there was a fellow in there who came, a Russian Jew. He came, there had two daughters there, and they made me a party, and they introduced me to all his friends. So I had a very good, but the young people in here, my age group, to me, they were completely empty-handed. Empty-handed. They had no idea what was going on in the war. And if you told them something which was going on, they were just not interested. They couldn't give a damn. They didn't give a damn what was going on in the war. All they were interested to have entertainment and to have fun. Right? That's all they were interested in. I could not believe it.
It's a very different way of life here.
Ah, it was completely not real. And on top of it, my uncle, you know, which was came from Poland, was my uncle. My mother, you know, he came from Poland as a young man in here. He became more Australian than Australians. He became more popestlicher with the popes. You know, that's a Yiddish saying, you know, he became more pope than the pope. And the first thing he told me was that I cannot live in Australia with a name like Weinreich. He was a wonderful man, good-hearted, wonderful man. He wanted the best for me. So he said, why can't I live like Werner? Because nobody will be able to pronounce it. So I said, what do you suggest, my dear uncle? What should I do? He said, your name is Weinreich. This is Wein, and Reich is rich. So either we'll call you Mr. Rich, or we'll call you Mr. Wein. I said, look, I don't like wine, and I'm not rich. If I have got to change my name to Wein, to Rich or to Weiner, I take the next boat and go back to Poland. So you know what he told me? I'll never forget what he told me. He said, you'll do very well in this country, you bastard, because you're stubborn. I got on very well with him later on, and he helped us a lot.
So eventually you settled down here, you married.
I settled down here, I met my wife. So my auntie, which was Australian, you know, once had a heart and heart conversation with me, said, I want to introduce you to the finest families in Sydney. You want rich? Rich. You want poor? Poor. You want religious? Religious. I said, auntie, my wife, I'll find myself. So what are you going to do? You don't like the girls in here. I said, no, I don't. I said, I'll go to Israel. I'll stay there for 6-7 months. I'll find myself a wife. I had friends in here, and they told me, my sister is coming from Israel for a visit. Right? And at the time, we had a factory with mattresses and furniture, you know? My uncle and I. Not this one, another uncle. I went in there, you know, and I measured it out because they had a special nook, you know? And Saturday morning, I delivered the mattress, and I come down from there, and I see this girl coming up, this beautiful girl, coming up with uncle and auntie crying. And I came home, and my auntie Mina lived opposite us, you know, in Natama, you know? I was very close with auntie Mina. I was more close with auntie Mina than with my mother, because my mother was very possessive. You know, she lost her husband, she lost her son, she lost everybody, right? So she was very possessive. So I said to auntie, I met my wife today. He said, you crazy, me sugar, you know, come and tell me the story. So anyway, she came next Saturday and we started going out. There was no question about it, we're going to get married, you know. I didn't even ask her to get married.
And when were you married?
In 15th of November, 53.
And you have children as well?
I've got the most glorious and the most beautiful children a family can have.
What are their names?
My eldest daughter is Lillian. She's an architect. And she's a wonderful painter. As you can see, there's lots of painting in here which Lillian's done. Very proud of her. And my second daughter is a business lady. And my son is a lawyer, but he doesn't practice law. He's in business. Now, I just want to tell you quickly, because you're talking about marriage. I was working in Newtown, and I was going by tram. I was going to my uncle's factory, you know, to learn the trade. I was going by tram. On the right-hand side was the University of Sydney. And I was always looking at the University of Sydney and said, may God help me. I didn't believe much in God, but anyway, I said, may God help me one day when I get married that my children should go into this university and finish this university. And I must tell you, all three of them went to that university and all finished with honors. And this was the happiest moment in my life. I had a few happy moments, of course, when I got married, when my son was bar mitzvah, and all three children, when I saw them walking around, you know, getting their degrees with their heads, because this is completely strange to us, you know, with heads with chalatas, you know, and they were, you know, tipping their heads to the professor there, you know, that was the most happiest moment of my life. There was a realization of a dream that is incredible.
Mr. Weinreich, I want to thank you for the time, for the interview. In closing, is there anything that you would like to add?
Yes, just a very short one, that I am a very lucky man, that I went through a war, and I met such a wonderful person as Annetta. She is the most glorious wife and the most glorious person that you can come across, full of wisdom, full of strength, full of vitality. We're so well matched together. That's just unbelievable, you know. I was right when I said I'm going to marry her. She didn't even know that I was going to marry her. But anyway, and I have got the most glorious and most beautiful and most lovable children that a man can ever, ever imagine. And for this, I'm grateful. I don't know to who I should be grateful, but I am grateful that out of the ashes, right, I have risen like a falcon. And nothing, you know, we have got tremendous strength of character. Nothing can stress me. Nothing can throw me. I can handle any situation because I've got always this behind in my mind. What my wife went through and what I went through, you know, and we didn't need any psychiatrists or any psychologists or anybody like this. We helped one another. You know, and we became completely normal people, and putting all this behind us, and the children, they never felt it. They were brought up in an atmosphere of love and beauty and elegance. And my wife has got tremendous taste, right? And she's an artist in a way, right? And you know, to come to such a point is I don't want to use the same sentence my wife used because I heard her saying it, but I also have got to say that we have lived to this moment.
Thank you very much. We'll take the break. Thank you. Mr. Weinreich, would you like to introduce the lovely lady sitting next to you?
The champion. This is my wife, Annetta, the most beloved lady in town. Okay? In the world, I should say.
And the two of you have brought up three lovely children into Australia. After all that you've both been through, because I understand that you're also a survivor, how do you think that the experiences of what you've been through affected your lives in Australia?
Well, first of all, when I arrived in Australia, I arrived on the 27th of March to Australia. And
53.
In 53. And the next day I met my husband. So that was one of my very happy moments in life. And then we got married and we have a very, very happy married life. We are married for 42 years. We never quarrel. We understand life and we know what to expect from life. The experiences what we went through does help us a lot because it strengthens us.
So, it's okay.
So we are strong people, but yet very soft. That's how we are.
Two sides to the story. We're strong on one side, but my wife is very emotional. You know, when it comes to things, that she becomes very emotional. I think that made us very, very strong. And we can take any stress in our way, which is given in our way, and we overcome it. We overcome it.
There is not a thing that we will not overcome.
Because we didn't have it easy in Australia.
No.
Mind you, we worked very hard for every cent we've got. We worked very hard. We worked day and night and bringing up three children.
Especially when we see people, you know, low down, we always stretch our hand because we know what it means, you know, hardship or, you know, So we're trying to help other people, if possible.
Have people in Australia approached you interested to know about what you've been through?
No.
No. Not even the family which survived,
no,
and which were not during the war in Poland, and which were here in Australia, or were in India or somewhere else, they never asked us how we survived,
and
or how the family died.
It is a great difference between the survivor.
Even the same family?
Yeah, in the same family, and between people in the same family that didn't survive the war.
That survived the war, but they were
yeah,
not in Poland
exactly.
during the war.
So it is, I feel it is a vast difference and completely different wavelengths. Up to that point that we sometimes don't understand each other.
Do you think that your children have learned from your experience?
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Oh, yes, they
no
have got a full
it.
Understanding. Absolutely. They understand what we went through. And
they're marvelous people.
Yes.
Marvelous
and
human
the
beings.
Way we are, they understand us more than we understand ourselves.
And, you know, not only love we get from them, but the respect they give us. It's just indescribable. They keep a tab on us. You know, the things have reversed. Instead of looking after the children look after us. Now, when my wife says, I just want to quickly, if we've got, how much more have we got? 1 minute, 2 minutes? When we came to Australia, it was a normal thing to help one another. You know, people came from overseas that couldn't speak English. Didn't have a job, right? It was a normal thing. I just wanted to do one story and that's it. Her mother is got Alzheimer, right? And we believe in going to the top people, right? So I found out who is the top man in Alzheimer diseases. So they told me there's a Professor Henry Brodati. I said, this rings a bell. Just let me think who he is. And I remembered. Because I when I came to Australia after 1 year, people used to come more often, you know, after I was here a year, I was already learned English. And people after me came in droves later on. And I was known as the big Chacham, you know, I was known as the big Macher, you know, because I spoke English and they couldn't speak English. Right? So I was looking for jobs for them and so forth and houses to live in and flats to live in and so on. And I said to my wife, this rings a bell, let me think. And I remembered. On the second, why I remembered was my friend of mine rang me up on the second day of Rosh Hashanah. And although I'm, you know, the God story is not so kosher, but I don't travel in Rosh Hashanah or Yom Kippur. And he said, there's a family in Cremon which, if we don't give them a hand, they'll die. There's a husband and a wife and a small child. And they'll die. And I said, okay, Rosh Hashanah will be over. I've got a truck. We'll go and see them. No, no, no. He said, you know, even a doctor is obliged to see after people, even Shabbat, to break the Shabbat. We're going now. Now more religious than you are. So I went there and had a look. And these people live really in a keila. They live in a keila. We could see people walking in there. Their husband was sick, and their mother was sick, and their little boy of three was sick, and he was snoring. Sit down, let me see what we can do. First of all, I went to the corner shop, and I bought food, right? Bread and butter and cheese and everything else, put on the table, eat. Boy needs a wash. I went upstairs, I hear a child crying, and I knocked on the door, and I said, listen, give me something to wash the boy. So they gave me Australian people, wonderful people, give me, and I washed the boy. So now what do we need? I need a job, and I need some place to live. Okay. So I said, job? No problem. You can have 10 jobs tomorrow morning, because there was a shortage of people. I've got a cousin, Mulumuru, who's got a factory of knitting, I'll get you a job. And what about, so the wife says she also needs a job, but she needs to put the boy into kindergarten. So I looked up in the telephone book, and I got him into the kindergarten. I carried him to the kindergarten. And he was knocking me, and he was pushing me, you know, when I got him to the kindergarten. And then I said to him, to my wife, you know what? That name rings a bell. And I ring up to Mr. Brodati, to Professor Brodati in the hospital. I said, I would like to speak to him. And 2 days later, he's busy, you know. 2 days later, he rings me up. What can I do for you? I said, my mother-in-law, I think, I'm not a doctor. I think she's got Alzheimer, and you're the specialist in Alzheimer. Help me. He said, I'm not looking after private people. I'm looking after... You know, he's got the whole Alzheimer disease, you know, in Australia he's got it in his hands, right? I'll give you a good colleague who will look after him. I said, no, no, no. His father died on Alzheimer. And I said, you ring up to your mother now. I said, and you say, Weinreich is calling, he needs help. I said to my wife, 10 minutes later, if he catches his mother, he'll ring you back. He rings me back and he said, what can I do for you? That is the Professor Brodati, which I carried to the kindergarten.
And he did help us quite a lot.
Oh, he was marvelous to us.
It's very nice.
Not a cent did I have to pay him. And I wouldn't pay money if you asked me for
he
it.
He came to our home because my mother
he came
was
in
the
here.
Hospital. She would not know to any. She would not.
He
know
was the biggest. He's the biggest man in this field.
Yeah,
that's very nice.
Right. So we see, as Mama said, we're strong. We're tough, but in the same time, when it comes to tachlis, there's no such a thing as not to help.
Okay.
Other people.
Thank you very much.
We also would like to thank Steven Spielberg that prompted us to tell our story, you know, Holocaust story, to perpetuate. So
what are you crying now for? Love.
So our children will be able to refer to the story and know exactly what we went through. And I have got a separate tape. And
they will look at it with a great lot of fondness and happiness and you know and gratefulness, and everything is going to be okay, not to worry.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you. Can you tell us about this photo, Mr. Weinreich?
Certainly. Now, as you can see, this is the wedding of my youngest uncle, John, to his beautiful wife. Now, this is my mother, this is my father, this is my grandfather, Simche Schreiber, this is Abish, this is Mina, and this is Avrum Hirsch, the one which died on my hands in Russia. And these are family of the color.
Tell us about your grandfather, Schreiber.
Grandfather Simche Schreiber had a terrible fate. He ran away with his family, with his second wife. He ran away with the second wife, and he ran away with three sons and with his daughter-in-laws and six children. He ran away to Tarnów. And when they came to Tarnów, they were hidden by a Polish fellow, by a Polish man in a bunker, what they call a bunker in those days. And my grandfather had a lot of money with him, a lot. He had it in gold coins, in American gold coins. He was a very rich man. And, you know, as the time was passing, a piece of bread was getting dearer and dearer and dearer, you know. It was ridiculous, you know, because they were completely in his hands. So they were hidden in underneath the house. And nobody knew where they were. And the fellow used to bring them bread. And every time he used to bring bread, there was bigger extortion, more money, more money, money. Finally, in the beginning of 1945, just before the war finished, his money ran out. And the same man went to the Gestapo and told them that the Jews are hiding in such and such a place. And they got him out, the whole lot. They were alive, the whole lot, because we've got witnesses. They got him out into the backyard, and my grandfather asked him to wait just a minute, because he knew they're going to shoot him. So he wants to put on the talis and tefillin, you know, before he gets shot. And when my daughter was painting, you know, she asked me once what sort of a painting I would like. So I tell her, make me a painting after Chagall of the Jew with a talis and tefillin. And this is exactly what my grandfather and my father looked like, right? And the whole lot were shot on that backyard. And after the war, my uncle John, which was in the Polish army, went back with a Russian officer to try and catch the fellow. They were going to hang him in the middle of the street. But as soon as he found out that they were looking for him, he ran away, he hid, and they couldn't find him. They were there for 3 weeks.
Okay. So, can you tell us about this photograph?
Yeah, this photograph was given to me by Uncle Lester, which was sent to him from Poland, right? And this is an original, which is priceless. Now, this is my grandfather, Simche. This is my father, Chaim. This is my mother, Fanny. Here I am as a baby of 1 year old. This is my brother. That is... grandmother, Simche's mother. This is Auntie Mina, and this is Avrum Hirsch. That is my auntie, and that's my uncle. And as you can see, I was a baby on my mother's lap. And this is Malka. So, and this is Lester, before you went to Israel, to Australia.
So this photo is from 1928,
is it? 28.
Okay, thank you. Tell us about the people in this photograph.
This is a very interesting photo. This man is the brother of my grandfather. He actually lived in Australia. He lived in America, and then he lived in Australia. He came home to visit his family, and he took this boy, Lester, which his name at that time was Liza, back to Australia, you know, he brought him to Australia. He said, Simcha, you give me one of your sons to go to Australia. And he took him. That's my brother. That's Abish. And these people I don't know. This is family, but I don't know. But this is Malka. This I know for sure, and that's Mina.
Okay. Tell us about the people in this photograph.
This is a very interesting photo. As you know, my uncle Lester came to Sydney, Australia. He married a Jewish girl from the Whitman family. Very well known here, a family, and they went and they came back, I think it was 1935, to Australia, and part of their honeymoon. They went to Paris, they went to London, and they came to Khrushchev. And you can imagine what a shock that was for her when she saw Khrushchev coming from Sydney. And now, this is Uncle Lester, that's her husband, that's Uncle John, this is my mother, this is Avrum Hash Blumenfrog, my uncle, my auntie, this is Bernard, I love that boy, and that's my auntie, that's their baby, that's their girl, and this is a cousin, Jen, which, this is Simcha Schreiber, the patriarch of the family, and this is Simcha, and this young boy is Jen, who actually lives here in Sydney.
Okay. These are the famous letters that you were speaking of in the video. Can you tell us about this one?
That is correct. This is the last letter which my father wrote to me, to Korostolovka, to Russia. As you can see, it's Khrushchev. The date is the 3rd of the 6th, 41. And Chaim is the, he just sent Chaim. And that's, he still lived at home in Esterplatz, which German name was Esterplatz, was Platz Estere 2 in Khrushchev. This is a very famous letter. I knew every word by heart. And here he writes, as you can see, with so much affection, meine liebe teure Freidel, my dearest, darling, wife, Freidel, you know. And half a letter is for my mother, and half a letter is for me. And this is a most touching letter that you can imagine. And here he writes to be respectful to my wife, to my mother. So it'll be always good to me to learn Hebrew with a rabbi. And actually here he says farewell. He says, in this letter he says farewell. That shortly it will be going away, they're going to take us away from the city. And we don't know our fate, and my heart is bleeding, and I'm full of pain, and I am idle like a stein, you know, I'm alone like a stone. And with the last drop of my blood, I'm writing this letter. And this is a letter which is unforgettable, and actually speaking, this letter gave me a lot of heart and a lot of strength. Despite the fact that it was so tragic, right? So this is that famous letter. That's one of them. I've got others.
Okay. These are the famous postcards from your brother. Can you tell us
about
them?
Now, my brother was taken early in the peace. Then Germans walked in. They took able-bodied young men to Germany to work on their different factories. And my brother, as you can see, wrote in German, which was not his mother tongue, because otherwise it wouldn't go through the censor. And now you can see quite clearly where he was. It is from Moses Weinreich, written to my father Chaim, to Khrushchev. My father was still in Khrushchev. And it's here, RAB Lager 3, Sakrau, by Ugebon, something like that. You know, so he was there. And he writes in here, and these letters, these cards were written to my father, and my father sent them to us in Russia so that we could read it. And they are most, they really and truly are ripping your heart.
Can you tell us a little bit?
Yeah, so you can see he underlined here. He writes to his dear father, you know, send me some tobacco. He never smoked, but probably that time he started smoking. And he sent me some food. And I'm so tired, he writes in here, at the end of the day, I can't even lift my hand. Right? And I'm working on the rail, you know, and a lot of my friends, here he writes, a lot of my friends are going on holidays. In other words, what he meant by it, the ones which are really weak, you know, they're going to take them to Auschwitz, right? And then finally they took him to Auschwitz as well. And I've forgotten to tell you that my father died in Auschwitz, in Oświęcim, and I have got an eyewitness that my brother actually died in Auschwitz, and how he died was very tragic. He just sat down, he leaned against the wall, and he died of malnutrition and also dysentery. And that's how my brother died in Auschwitz. And for years and years and years, I was always hoping that I will see them coming through the door. And I one of the reasons why I went to Poland back is to go to Auschwitz and to say Kaddish, so that their souls will rest in peace finally, because they have got no mitzvah, they've got nothing. And I felt that if I don't say Kaddish in the place that actually they died, I will not be doing my duty as a son or my duty as a brother. And I really adore them.
Okay. Tell us about this particular document.
This particular document is from the school when I was in Gzlorda, the end of the year report, right? As you can see, I was an excellent pupil. In literature, I had four, you know, it was every 3 months or whatever they gave assessment. I was five was the highest, right? So I was fives. I had German was five, and historia I was three, five, four. Kazakhsky Yazyk I didn't take. Geography I was excellent, fives. Arithmetic I wasn't so good. Geometry I was not, it was good. Physics I was 4, 4, 4, which was very good. Biology I was very good. And altogether, you know, my marks were very high. And for a fellow who didn't speak one word of Russian when he came to the school, and to reach such high standard in education was quite a feat, believe me. I beat the Russians.
It's very impressive. Okay. Tell us about the lady in these photographs.
The lady in these photographs, a friend of mine, a man, a very lovely fellow, you know, he went to the army, and very shortly afterwards he came back. And he was, unfortunately, he tripped on a mine and he lost both legs. And he was in the hospital. And later on, he met this wonderful, beautiful girl and he married her. I was the best man on the wedding. And he insisted that he goes under the chuppah with his legs, which is false legs, without a stick, without any props. And I was holding him and we went under the chuppah together. And I was very, very fond of him, and she was a beautiful girl, and they got visas to go to Palestine after the war. And this is what a beautiful girl, what a beautiful, you know, what a beautiful child.
Thank you. Tell us about the people in this photograph.
This is a very good photo of my mother and my auntie, Mina. I was very, very close to Mina, and I loved them very much. And this is my mother, and they were wonderful sisters. Right, and that's all I can tell you about this photo. That this is, I'm very fond of this photo, because it's so clear and it's so nicely done. Right.
This is an older photograph, and can you tell us about this one?
Yes, this is the only photo which I've got of my brother together with me as children in Chrzanów, and this photo we got from my uncle in Israel. You know, my mother sent him the photo. That must have been somewhere in 1930, you know. And when I came to Australia, I asked him, could you send me some photos from home? And he sent me this photo.
Do you know who took the photograph?
No idea.
Okay.
It's a beautiful photo.
Tell us about the two people in this photograph.
Now, this was my teacher in Gzlorda. He was teaching us Polish. Not only was he my teacher, but he was a distant family from Avraham Blumenfruch. Mr. Blumenfruch, my uncle, and Mrs. Lilienthal, and his name was Lilienthal, were brothers and sisters. So they looked after me. They sort of adopted me like I was their only child, you know, a child. And they really and truly looked after me. And from him, I learned a lot about the world, what's going on in the world. And he died many years ago in Tel Aviv. And Mrs. Lilienthal is alive and well in Tel Aviv. She's over 90, and her brain is as sharp as it was 50 years ago, and she's extremely fond of my wife as well, which I'm very grateful to her. And she's a woman of tremendous intelligence, and I love her very much. And when we go to Tel Aviv, I make a point and seeing her. And by, I don't know, for some strange reason, I'm not a crier and I don't cry very much. But when I see her, I cry.
This is an important document. Can you tell us about this one?
Yes. This little document was given to us in Zloda, to my mother and me. As you can see, the name is completely misspelled because that was a Russian fellow which wrote out those things, and he could hardly write Polish. So the name is completely misspelled. But from on this little piece of paper, we traveled from Gzloda to Poland, and this was our passport to freedom. And you know, the funny part of the lot is this first word is in Polish and the next one here is Russian, right? But this little piece of paper gave us the passport to go. This is the passport to go to Poland. And in here you can see that I lived in Gzloda, he writes, and the rayon, that means like the like New South Wales, you know, it's Gdorlinskom Vatesa. And here, actually, I can tell you in which street I live in Gzloda. Ulica Kanakan-Raska, number 20. This is a beautiful document.
Okay. Tell us about the person in this photograph.
The person in this photograph is the only photo I've got of my father's brother. His name is Shlomo Weinreich, and he lived in Bielsko together with his wife and two girls. And he actually perished also in Auschwitz. And his wife and the two girls have, I've got a photo of the two girls, we'll see later on, have actually survived the war, and they went to Israel, and the two girls died very early in the peace when they came to Israel. From what I understand, one actually, her mind went and she committed suicide, and the other one died because on both of these girls, from what I understood from my mother, the Germans made experiments. And they just did not survive very long after the war.
And where does this photograph come from?
This from Bielsko, from a city called Bielsko.
Okay. These are the ladies that you were speaking of. Can you tell us the names?
Yes. These are the names of my two beautiful cousins, Paula, and I've forgotten the other one.
Helen.
Yes, Paula and Helen. And they are my cousins from Bielsko. And this is the only photo I've got of my cousins. And these are the girls which did not survive very long after. They were already in the best conditions, with the best help in Palestine, and later on Israel, of course. They just could not survive because their bodies did not take the punishment that they have received during the war. And they died at a very early age. Okay. Young girls.
This is another member of the Schreiber family?
Yes, this is my uncle Bernard. I was tremendously fond of him. He was a joker. He was a happy, jolly man. And I really and truly loved this guy. And on top of it, I loved him because he had a colossal voice. He used to sing so beautifully. It was just a pleasure to listen to him. And he used to sing in the synagogue, in the little choir, and I used to love listening to him. And I was very proud of him.
Tell us about the people in this photograph.
I'm very, very fond of this photo, and I'm very fond of the people in this photo. This is my mother's brother, Menachem. As you can see, he looks Palestinian, like a Jew from Israel. They lived in Haifa. The grandfather sent the money to build the house, which I was telling you about. And as you can see, not only were my family merchants and scholars, but they were also fighters. This fellow was in the Jewish brigade during the war. I meet him every time I go to Israel. I meet him, he's alive, he's well. And he told me once that he had four passports in his pocket with $1 million. And he was one of the people which were responsible of taking the Jewish refugees to Trieste from German camps. And he was helping them on their way to Palestine by legal or illegal ways. And this is his mother, of course. This is Clara. She's still alive in Israel. And unfortunately, his brother died.
And the gentleman at the top?
This is Moshe Schreiber, my cousin. And I'll tell you something else with him, that we are so much alike that the first time when my wife saw him, she got a shock. Because we speak the same, we look the same. And when the last trip we were this year, we were in Israel in the beginning of the year, he took us for a drive, in Haifa, and we were singing the same songs from home, and he never was in Chanuf. because his father taught him, and my father taught me, and my grandfather taught me.
It's quite remarkable.
It's remarkable. My wife couldn't believe it. She just could not believe it. He loves my wife too. Loves her. You know, we are very close with him.
Okay. Tell us about this photograph.
This photograph. This is my second cousin. His name is Samuel Goldberger. And why I'm showing you this photo is for two reasons. First of all, I'm very proud to see that that our family was fighters as well. I showed you Moshe Schreiber. He was in the Israeli army, right? And now this man was in the Polish army. And he was fighting, and he was fighting right through the war up to in Warsaw. In Warsaw, he got shot. He lost one eye, and he was also here grazed with bullets, right? And you see, when I look at him, I love it because we were fighting. Look at his gun in here on the side, right? And he sent us actually the parcels. He stole goods in Warsaw, and he sent us parcels to Russia. He was very fond of my mother. And when Yom Kippur was here, actually after the war, he was given a colossal big flat and a business in the mountains in Germany, you know, which the Poles took over, as I told you, Silesia. And the minute I came, he took me to the mountains where he had this business, and I was there with him for 1 month to recuperate, you know. And I would always remember him. You know, he died, and unfortunately, you know, he was here. He struggled a little bit as far as money was concerned and so forth. And then he was a Zionist. So he went back to Israel. And from Israel, he went back to Poland because his wife is Polish. And he had to look at this, in Poland. And on the way back to Australia, the strain was so big for him that he had a heart attack in Switzerland or in Holland. I think in Holland. In the hotel, he had a heart attack and died. And we brought his body in here to bury. His heart could not take the stress, what he saw. He was over the moon in Israel, and he was very stressed in Poland. I'm very fond of him. I was very fond of him.
Okay. Tell us about this document, Mr. Weinreich.
This document is a card, a registration card with the Jewish committee in Krakow. When we arrived, as I told you, we had no money, we had no clothing, we had nothing. So they, the Americans, used to send a little bit of money, a little bit of clothing to Poland, and it was in a warehouse there with a Jewish committee, and there's two entries in here. One entry is help, money help, which they gave us 700 zlotys, which was nothing, very little, and a little bit of clothing, which I can't even tell you what they gave me, but a little bit of, probably a couple of shirts or something like that. So this is this. You know.
What have you here, Mr. Weinreich?
This is what the Polish people call zaświadczenie. It was given out in Krakow, as you can see, in Krakow, on the 10th of the 8th, 46, and misspelled the name again. And this is to certify that Joseph Weinreich, which was born in Chrzanów, the son of Chaim and Fanny Schreiber from home, who lives on such and such a street, has called into this office, and he's going to be inducted into the Polish army. And of course, I will let you know when to come and to face, whatever it is. And so this is a document to state that I was going to go to the Polish army.
This photograph is from an important day. Can you tell us?
Yeah, this is one of my most happiest days of my life. As you can see, that was the wedding when I got married to Aneta. And my mother very proudly in the middle, and incredible how beautiful she was on that day. And she's beautiful till today, even more so. She's getting more beautiful every day. And I think we are very lucky couple.
Okay. Tell us about this lovely picture.
This is a beautiful photo. I'm very fond of it. This you can see, there's Lillian, Michelle, and Henry, children growing up when they're small kids.
And which one is Lillian?
Lillian is the eldest.
Yes.
Michelle is the middle one, and Henry is the youngest. She always asked me that, she was not sure whether she was adopted or not. That was really something, because the middle child has always got some sort of, she wasn't sure. I said, I can assure you, you are ours, and we love you more than anything.
Okay, this would have been a very proud moment for you.
This was, as I told you, I had a few happy days in my life, and this was definitely one of them. I was so proud and so happy to see my beautiful eldest daughter graduating from one of the best universities in the world, from Sydney University, and look how beautiful she looks in this outfit. You know, it's just incredible that from a little fellow from Khshanov to reach this height, plenty to be thankful for.
Another happy moment for you?
Yes, Michelle was at that time in Los Angeles, and she came especially from Los Angeles for her graduation. And she said to me that she felt always that she's done the right thing. She wasn't sure whether she wanted to come back or not for the graduation, you know, because it was a long trip. But let me tell you something. As you can see, I'm so proud that Michelle also graduated in political science, right? And both girls, intelligent, clever, wise, warm-hearted. They deserve the best in the world.
Okay. And the last member of the Weinreich family?
This is our son, dearest and beloved son, Henry, at his graduation. He's handsome, he's clever, he's intelligent, he's got a heart of gold, he's full of goodness, and not only to us and not only to his sisters, but he's very humane, and there's nobody like him anywhere in the world. I've traveled the world over, I've seen people, and of course I'm biased, but I can honestly say that there's nobody like him. And there's nobody like Michelle, and there's nobody like Lillian. People like this does not exist. And we have survived. Sometimes I feel that we have survived for one reason only, to have such lovely children.